tetragrammaton.
I was born in Atlanta, Georgia, in College Park. And then 3 months after I was born, my dad got a job. Well, he had got the job right before I was born at CBS, Channel 2.
Doing what?
TV news cameraman. So the guys and girls that hop out the trucks with the cameras. So he'd shoot stuff, produce stuff. So he'd shoot stuff in New York, but he also traveled around the world for CBS. He did that for 38 years. When I was 3 months old, me and my mom and my brother moved up to New York with him. So we first lived in Flushing for about 88 years. And then when I was like 10 years old, we moved to Jamaica, Queens.
And describe that world.
Man.
You have fond memories?
I have all kinds, the whole cornucopia of it. The block I lived on, Keysville, loads of kids the same age as me lived there. So it was like the Boulevard, Farmers Boulevard, which you're familiar with from, you know, LL, mm-hmm. who you worked with and stuff like that. So he lived on Ilion, where his grandmother lived. I lived two streets up. So he's on Ilion, off of Ilion and Farmers. I'm on Farmers in Keysville. And it's literally like, I can name off like 20 guys that grew up on that block. Yeah, so it was fun growing up with like that many people around the same age as me. I'd pull out my basketball hoop and we'd have like more than a full squad, like too many people. And then other people from other blocks would come and we'd have these wars between blocks. Like, you know, the main one was Hilburn versus Keysville. It was fun, but also it was post crack epidemic. So the neighborhood was pretty dilapidated, didn't have a lot of support from the city. So the school sucked. And there was a lot of crime. Not as much as it was during the crack epidemic.
Do you remember pre-crack as well?
I know about St. Albans pre-crack, but I didn't live there during then. And that's the interesting thing about St. Albans was pre-crack epidemic, Miles Davis lived there. Loads of people lived there. And it was actually considered one of the most affluent black neighborhoods in America. Like an example, the whole, you know, everyone's talking about the RICO law. Like even Young Thug's trial, the RICO trial. RICO law was created in my neighborhood because this gangster from my part of town named Fat Cat, he put a hit on a cop. And George Bush held that cop that got killed. On news, he had his badge and was like, we're going to stop this. And it created the RICO law that had all kinds of social and economic repercussions. You know, Supreme Team, South Side, North Side, super close. But then loads of beautiful things too, loads of music, you know. Hollis was right down the way, Run DMC.
Would you describe it as urban or not?
Oh yeah.
But it wasn't like Manhattan.
Mm-mm. It wasn't the city. And it also wasn't Brooklyn. It's funny, like, I remember one time, this is like early 2000s. We went to go see Dave Chappelle in Long Island. And my boy from the Bronx, I was with a bunch of dudes from Bronx and Harlem, we went. That I used to work with at Bertolf Goodman. We were all stock guys. They dropped me off. And I remember G, he was just at my wedding. I've known G a long time. He's like, well, fuck, I thought you lived in the hood. Y'all got houses and front lawns. So Queens, where we're at, there's houses, lawns, backyards. And, you know, a lot of people.
It looked more suburban.
It does. It does.
Yeah.
You know? So does Hollis. You know, you've been around Hollis. It looks suburban. This house is in the center third.
Yeah.
And that's the interesting dyad of the suburban look, but then with the socioeconomic downturn underbelly, the crime underbelly, then there's the music, the sports, the arts. Like, I literally grew up between, like LL's from Ilion, Tribe Called Quest is up from Farmers in Linden, up by Grady's Liquor Store where I used to work at, you know, running them from down to Hollis, 50 Cent. Like, one of my OGs used to hustle for 50 Cent. Like, that was my So all these things, this confluence of the music, sports. So that's why I always say, like, growing up there was like the Sandlot, that movie Sandlot.
Yeah.
Mixed with like Boys in the Hood. You know, that was my upbringing. So it was like fun, beautiful stuff that I couldn't experience anywhere else in the world. But then like some of my friends were getting killed and shot, going to jail, all kinds of stuff.
Hypothetical question. How different do you think your life would be had your family stayed in Atlanta?
Really different.
Yeah.
Really different. Or even if we stayed in Flushing.
Yeah.
You know, we moved to Jamaica, Queens because my parents couldn't afford a house in Flushing or Bayside or anywhere like that. And because of like redlining and just, you know, Jamaica, Queens was, especially then, super homogenous. There's no white people. The only white people were the police, you know, and the only people that weren't black were like the guys who ran the bodegas and the people who ran the Chinese food stores. You know, everyone else, bus drivers, black, postman's black. But even me growing up during those 9 years in Flushing, which was mostly like Asian, white, a little bit Hispanic, very few black people, even that gave me those 9 years gave me a different thing. And then obviously just my parents, who they are, and then.
Tell me about your parents.
How we spent our weekends. Just great people, you know what I mean? And I also say, I always say, call them radicals in relation to where they came from, because both my parents came from a really small town called Harlem, Georgia, which is 20 miles from Augusta, Georgia. One red light town, 1,500 people. Mom and dad went to the same high school that both their grandmothers went to. Both my grandmothers were in the same graduating high school class. It was my grandma Liza's birthday yesterday. She just turned 97.
Wow.
Yeah. So I spent my summers there. So every summer my parents would send me down there. But anyway, yeah, my parents are radicals because most people didn't move out of there.
They dreamed of a better life or a different life.
Different life,
than
yeah.
the small town that they came from.
Did, you know what? I asked my dad this question several years ago. I said, what made you want to leave Georgia, Harlem, Georgia? What made you move to New York? He said, the movie Shaft. Because he said when he saw the movie, he felt in New York you could be who you want to be. And he didn't feel that way in Harlem, Georgia, the South, that him and my mom could be who they want to be and experience all the things they want to experience. So, you know, they had an interesting road getting out of there. You know, like my dad literally, he was a brick mason. He learned from my grandfather. And this is around when he was like 19. My dad had been working since he was like 6, 7 years old. His first job was picking cotton for a sharecropper. Everyone's first job was picking cotton because farmers liked having kids do it, because kids could pick more because they didn't have to bend over. So you could pick the cotton faster. So that was my dad's first job. My dad said he'd been driving a car since he was like 8, 9 years old. Real country shit. And he's 18, 19 at a burger joint. And it was his lunch break and he wanted like a vanilla milkshake. So he went and he's in line and he heard these two army recruiters talking about, and mind you, Vietnam's going on at this time. They're like, hey, you know, we just need a couple more guys to sign up. You know, we got to get out of here in the morning. We got to try to sign up a couple more people. You know, then we're not going to be back for a couple months. And then my dad heard them say that. And they were in front of a couple people in front of them. They got their food and left out the restaurant. And he went and got offline and ran after them and stopped them. He said, hey, I overheard you guys talking about the army stuff. And he's like, yeah. They said, look, if you go to the army, you'll be able to take care of your family no matter what happens to you with the GI Bill and all these things. You come out, you get out of there, you'll be able to go to school for free. You'll learn a job and you'll be able to take care of your family for the rest of your life if you go in there and you do what you're supposed to do. So my dad went home that night to my mom, his wife, and my older brother, who was probably 1, and said, hey, these guys are leaving in the morning. They won't be back for months. what should we do? Because they both wanted to get out. So they made the decision that night at dinner, and that morning he left to go do basic training to go to Vietnam. And the story even gets weirder and more interesting. But by the time he finished training, Vietnam got shut down by LBJ. While he was there, my dad wanted to be a dental assistant. He's like, this is a job I can get, be a good job. All of the ORs, which are called the jobs, were taken up except for to be a Charlie Mopic, which is a motion picture cameraman. That was the only OR. And my dad was like, there's no way you guys can get me into the dental thing. And they're like, nope, you have to take this. And then he got into it. And then he said his instructors were these two rednecks. And he said, these guys had worked in TV news. I remember my dad told me, last time he told me the story, I've heard my dad cry like a couple of times in my life. And this is one of the times, like literally, I remember my dad crying this time when the cops that shot Amadou Diallo got off, when my mom passed away. I literally can remember all the times my dad's cried, a couple of times. Anyway, he was telling me a story and he started tearing up. The guy said to him, they're like, we can't change how this country treats black people. We don't agree with it. But what we can do is train you so good that you always be able to have a job being a cameraman if you want to be, being a motion picture photographer. We're going to make you the best. Because normally when you begin in that job as a cameraman, learning to shoot film, they have you carrying tripods and shit and holding the boom. They had him doing everything, all the main stuff from the very beginning. And they just sat back and just trained them the best they could.
Why do you think they did that?
I don't know. My dad still remembers these guys' names. This was back, my dad's turning 69. This was when he was 19 years old. I just think these guys were radicals in their own way. They were just humane people.
It's a beautiful story.
Yeah.
And did your dad come to like camera work?
Yeah, he fell in love with it and became great at it. He got a whatever the highest discharge you can get. He was in the Army for 6 years. Filmed all kinds of missions, like Panama Canal stuff, all kinds of stuff.
Wow, cool.
All around the world. And then he came out and he started working at, he worked for an affiliate down in Atlanta. And so him and my mom and my brother were down there and he was shooting news and he was great.
You weren't born yet?
Nah.
How much older is your older brother?
He's 9 years older than me.
Mm.
Yeah. But yeah, that was my mom and dad, you know, and then the whole, you know, they were a team and their whole thing was just getting out of Harlem, Georgia and enjoying life, you know. And even when they're in Atlanta, they tell me the stuff they get into, always going to music shows, always going to stuff, you know, very active. And then when they had kids, they started incorporating us to all that, you know, like one weekend my mom, my mom would read the newspaper from the front to the back. Probably every day. She'd always see what was going on in the city on the weekends. We go to the city a lot on the weekends. And I remember one weekend, it was like, we went to go see Pavarotti for free at Central Park. I mean, the only thing I knew about opera is what I saw in a movie, you know? And then he had the Harlem Boys choir singing. He was singing with the Harlem Boys choir. But, you know, she felt that was something that her sons needed to see. That was not something that was even talked about in Jamaica, Queens.
Yeah.
So they afforded me and my brothers a really dynamic mix of culture, whether it was going to Yankees games or going to see Pavarotti or going to a Broadway play, going to a museum, going to different restaurants or just going around downtown and walking.
Would your mom take you to these places because she wanted you to see them or because she wanted to see them and you guys got to come?
It was more so the stuff they want us to see, but they'd be into it too. So yeah, I think it was both, you know? And then also the cool thing about my mom was she'd get into the things I was into or ask me critical questions. I told my wife, Andy, this story a couple weeks ago. Somehow we were talking about, or someone else, my man Lee Spellman from, he has a brand called Babylon, Trash. He's in a band called Trash Talk. We're talking about Onyx. Onyx also from a neighborhood My homegirl used to date one of them. My best friend's cousin used to date one of them. They were barbers. They cut hair in the Coliseum Mall. Anyway, my first rap album I bought was Throw Your Guns. The B-side to it was me and Jack, the Black Vagina Finder. So I was like, Mom, I want to buy this. I didn't know what the B-side was, right? If I knew what the B-side was, I probably would have been more clandestine about getting... I wouldn't have asked my mom to take me to go get this thing. You know what I mean? At whatever young age I was, so...
How old do you think you were?
Man, not even a teenager yet. Probably like 11 or something like that, 12. So then we go, we buy the single, and she looks and she sees the B-side, and she goes, do you know what a vagina is? And deadpan, and I was like, I do know what a vagina is. She's like, all right, you can listen to it then. You know what I mean? So her thing wasn't like censorship. It was about, do you understand what you're listening to? You know, do you understand what they're talking about? Do you understand that this is entertainment or this is music and you're a 12-year-old boy, so you're not doing that right now. But you can listen to it, though, because I know you're going to listen to it. She didn't say that, but she knew I'd listen to it anyway, mm-hmm. You know? That's another thing, too. Like, when they moved to New York, the guy that helped my dad get his job at CBS, he helped my dad get his job at CBS, and he's like, hey, Tracy, you're not going to go anywhere working in Atlanta. You've outgrown that place. CBS has to hire some black people because of affirmative action. So they're looking for talented cameramen of color. Right now, with your accolades in affirmative action, you could get a job. So my dad went up there, was like skeptical, and interviewed, came back, got the job. Went up for 3 months, lived in a room in Fort Greene back in the day until we moved up there so he could save up the money. I remember he told me, he said, when he went up there or when he took the job or when we moved, him and my mom had like a week's worth of pay in the bank or something. Like that's all they had in the world or something. And it was like, it was a risk because he was moving her up during a probation period. This same guy was like, yo, I know you love film. We should start a video store. So they opened up a video store in Elmhurst, East Elmhurst, Queens, you know? It was called Just Us Video, which was also wild too. It was like, that was my first intro to like graphic design because Play from Kid and Play worked there and he designed the store t-shirts and stuff. A lot of personalities, street cats, Salt and Pepper, Rakim, Coogee Rap, they'd come there and rent videos and stuff. Me seeing them just doing things they couldn't have done down there or would maybe not been exposed to.
It's also interesting, like a video store, much like a bookstore or a record store, it's just a cool place to hang out.
Exactly. Yeah, and the reason I bring up the video store is because they never censored me what I could watch. You know, I've watched thousands of films since I was a kid. It was just cool, man. You know, whether it was like Akira or, you know, Spike Lee films, like even like Spike Lee knew the guy that was my dad's business partner. So he figured they had some money. He asked my dad, the business partner, to invest in. She's got to have it. But all the money was tied up in the store. They didn't have any money. My mom and dad didn't have any personal money to invest in. She's got to have it. And the guy wouldn't allow my dad to invest the store money into She's Gotta Have It because he thought the film wouldn't do well because it was black and white. He didn't like the fact that Spike was shooting a black and white film. My dad told a funny story. He said he ran into Spike a couple years later and Spike was like, he was covering a story. Spike was being honored or something. And Spike was like, man, you should have invested. But it was funny. I told Spike that story. He remembered. He's like, tell your mom and dad. I said,
How much you think movies inspired your level of taste?
Yeah, I think it all started from the movies, you know? It's funny, a movie I had never seen before, and it's not a great movie, it's a Robert Redford movie called Sneakers. And it's about, they do espionage, and he has this company that they'll break it to a bank to show them where their weak spots are. It's Robert Redford, Sidney Poitier, Dan Aykroyd. I watched it, I was like, oh, this is a great cast, but the movie was all right. But there's this furniture piece. It's like a armchair, but made of steel, mesh steel. Anyway, I'm working with this furniture store that sells really amazing vintage furniture. And one of the pieces that I'm curating for them, which I had already chosen, was in this film that I watched a couple weeks ago. But I'm just using that to show is that, like, all the films I watch, whether it was Akira, Fist on a North Star, She's Gotta Have It, one of my favorite films is Chinatown. To this day, example, when I was getting my wedding suit made, I said to the tailor, Ralph Fitzgerald, I said, hey, I want it to fit like Chinatown. You know, so if I'm getting a suit, I go back to give the tailor, the suit maker, an example, I go to a film. You know, from everything to, like, I think my ideals of what I think romance is, how to treat my partner, and certain, you know, things I think you learn that right or wrong from a film. You know, even like you see a film and you see how someone's living, just the way their abode is. And that might just be one or two scenes, but you remember it and you're like, wow, I don't know anyone that has a house like that or a place like that. I don't know anyone that has that many books. When I grow up, I want to have that many books in my bookshelf, so on and so forth. Music, you know, even stuff now that I didn't catch, like we just watched the film The Last Emperor, and I didn't realize that the Japanese musician Roy Sach, I can't remember his name, he died recently, like last year. He did the soundtrack for this film. This is a film I've seen several times.
Ryuichi Sakamoto.
Yes. You know, he did the soundtrack for this film, or like watching Rumblefish. I didn't realize when I first seen Rumblefish that Stuart Copeland, who was the drummer in The Police, he did the soundtrack for that. But the soundtrack always stood out to me. This felt more emotive than the soundtrack of most films. And then you get older and you start reading the credits more, or you learn more. Because when I first saw that film, I didn't know who the drummer in The Police, but as I get obsessed with music and learning everything about bands that I like, you start connecting the dots across books, film, music, art, whatever it is, even, you know, performance art, anything. But yeah, I think my ideals of what taste is started with my mom and dad and that store. And it all, makes sense. That was the seed. It all grew from there. Yeah. And even when we moved, so when the store closed down in 87, when we moved to St. Albans, we had more space than the house, way more space than the house in Flushing. My uncle Ray or my dad, they built these shelves in the basement, and he took all the films out of U-Haul storage and put them on the wall. So then I became like the blockbuster in the hood. Like I remember like my man Reggie, his uncle would send Reggie at the middle of the night to knock on my basement window and be like, Tremaine, give me a Western. I give him a Western. He go take it to him. He'd be like, I seen this one already. He'd come back, bring it back. I give him a different Western, you know? Just shit like that, or like, you know, loaning out kung fu films. And my dad's like, where's that film? And I gotta go track it down. Now someone done lent the film, I lent to them to someone else. So then I gotta go to 20 projects to go get the knock on someone's door in a project to get my VHS back, you know? Cause those things were like gold. Cause it wasn't no streaming.
Yeah.
I wouldn't let a lot of people in the house, but when they saw that collection of VHSs and the word got out, it became a real currency. Then I started starting my own collection of Japanese anime in the early 90s. I would go to this place in Flushing called Japan Imports, take my little money I saved up and buy different movies and built up my own collection.
LMNT, LMNT Electrolytes. Have you ever felt dehydrated after an intense workout or a long day in the sun? Do you want to maximize your endurance and feel your best? Add LMNT Electrolytes to your daily routine. Perform better and sleep deeper. Improve your cognitive function. experience an increase in steady energy with fewer headaches and fewer muscle cramps. LMNT Electrolytes. Drink it in the sauna. Refreshing flavors include grapefruit, citrus, watermelon, and for a limited time, chocolate medley, which you can enjoy hot. Formulated with the perfect balance of sodium, potassium, and magnesium to keep you hydrated and energized throughout the day. These minerals help conduct the electricity that powers your nervous system so you can perform at your very best. LMNT Electrolytes are sugar-free, keto-friendly, and great-tasting. Minerals are the stuff of life. So visit drinklmnt.com/tetra and stay salty with LMNT Electrolytes. LMNT.
What was the first music that you felt like was your music? Not your parents' music, your older brother's music.
Boot Camp Click and Onyx and some late 80s rap and stuff like that. It felt mine, but when like Nas, Mobb Deep, all that stuff, that was like they're rapping about stuff and I'm seeing it happen. The Onyx stuff too, but it was just something about the sound was still harkening back to 80s a little bit for me. That's what it was. The Boot Camp Click, all they were rapping about the same stuff and they're different versions of it, but Mobb Deep, Wu, Nas, the sound was unto itself. And that sound felt like what I was living, you know what I mean? Those drums, that felt like what was happening in Jamaica, Queens.
It was a whole new wave of music, really.
Yeah. Yeah.
It wasn't just a continuation. It was it really was a new chapter in the story.
Yeah, they definitely like were sons of what came before, but they definitely cut the umbilical cord. The umbilical cord was cut and they were figuring out their own path. You know what I mean? They're on their own hero's journey.
So growing up, was hip hop everywhere? Like hip hop was the form of music around?
Yeah.
In your childhood?
As far as when I stepped out the house and hung out with my comrades, yes. For me, it wasn't the only thing because, again, I had my older brother who was obsessed with Prince, love rock. My dad listened to everything. Like my dad, he bought me Cop Killer iced tea. He was like, and my dad's funny too. He's like, and you got to keep this thing too. It's going to be worth money because they're banning this. You know, but it's also important because he has the right to, my dad was like, he has the right to say this stuff, you know? I don't think he's gonna kill a cop. He's saying this to express the feeling of despair because of the interactions between police and young black men in America. And that's why he made this song, so it's important. You know, my dad kicked all that to me. I was like, sick, you know? That was a wild album. Ice-T has a song, a storytelling song, about him dressing up as a Ku Klux Klan and going to like a rally and stuff like that. Him and his man are at a Ku Klux rally and the two black guys. Like it was wild, wild shit. But like amazing storytelling and like just, I listened to everything, man. Because the thing about me was, I was hanging out in Jamaica, Queens all the time, but then I still ride my bike and go back to Flushing to see my friends from Flushing. And then I started hanging out in the city on my own. I'd go to the city by myself and grab a Village Voice and just look at, you know, see what shows were happening at SOBs or wherever. Like, I remember, like, the parties in Jamaica, Queens would be, like, either dance hall, soca, or some rap shit. I loved it. I wanted to hear something else. I wanted to hear Prince. No one played Prince, right? I wanted to hear all kinds of stuff. And I say Prince because I went, I remember I was on First and First, and it was late at night. I was underage, I wasn't 21 yet, and I was walking down First and First by myself, took the F train to the First and First stop, and this bar, heard music, went in, and like, they're playing Raspberry Beret. And I could have cried because it was like, I'm getting to hear this song with people that I only been able to hear on my headphones.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Or like, you know, cats like Prince, but we were just deep into, like, even if we weren't listening to it, we'd be hanging out, you know, on the corner or in the neighborhood hanging out, and then someone start reciting lyrics from Nas, Take It In Blood. Then we all, it's like, we come like karaoke session. We're all just reciting the lyrics, three verses. You know what I mean? So, you know, as I hung out in the city, started to meet people, as I started working, and that's why I always tried to get jobs in Manhattan. So then that allowed me to, before the job and after the job, to hang around. But I'm also making money, so I'm supporting my life.
So how old are you when you start hanging out in the city by yourself?
Probably 16, 17.
And about what year is this?
Started in like 97, probably.
Describe what the New York scene's like what nightclubs were there, what was the world like?
I would say it was, if you're curious, you'll find fun, cool stuff to do.
Yeah, not, everything's available, but you wouldn't know, but you gotta hunt it down.
You gotta be curious, you gotta be on a search for something more. And when people saw that you were curious and interested, they would foster that, even strangers. You know, like even I remember my man Wilkins, he worked at Union, the store called Union, that I discovered just by walking in the city. When he was working there, I remember he was eating some food from a place called 12 Chairs. Anyway, I just met him, we became cool. And he's like, yo, you ever had Baba Ghanoush? I'm like, Baba go what? And he's like, Baba Ghanoush, it's, you know, it's Middle Eastern food. It's from a spot called 12 Chairs. I was like, nah, but I love food, so. He's like, yeah, you down? And then, because, you know, Wilkins was a Dominican dude, was not it, he still is, good friend of mine from Brooklyn. He knew I was like, you know, young dude from Queens. He's a couple years older than me. So he knew I didn't know what it was. And it was almost like he's testing me to see, am I curious or am I closed? Am I open or closed? You know, I might be reading too much into it, but I think I'm right, you know? So just that's like a little example of it. You know, it's just like, if you're curious, doors would open. Didn't matter how much money you had. What mattered was, were you curious, you know?
What'd they sell at Union?
Clothes, but a lot of the clothing was like either from Europe, Japan, and then he also sold a lot of independent brands. What people would call streetwear now, which
there was no such word back then.
It was just clothing.
Yeah.
But it was clothing that, again, why I related to so much was it was in real time. So just the same way the purple tape and stuff and It Was Written and Illmatic and Hell on Earth and all those records and all that stuff, I could see, I was living and seeing what was happening that they were rapping about and the music felt like. I remember I went in the Union, the year was 1999 or 2001, between that time, and Wilkins was working there. And I'm looking, it was a shirt with Sade on it. Now, you go to Urban Outfitters and see a shirt with Sade on it. But back then, to see a shirt with Sade on it, and you weren't at a concert, that didn't exist. I was like, wow, this is cool. And I love Sade. I remember Wilkins being like, you like that t-shirt? I'm like, yeah. And then he's like, and the t-shirt was like $28 or something, too much money for me at that time. Equivalent to a $50 t-shirt now or something. He took it, what size are you? I'm like a large. And he goes, grabbed the large and put it in a bag and gave it to me. And was like, he was like, yo, make sure you come back and see me though, you know? Now they call that seating. They call that whatever they call, like giving someone something free that in hopes that helps promote your brand.
Mm-hmm.
He's just giving it to it because he saw my interest, you know?
Yeah.
I'll never forget, there was this other store called Nom de Guerre. That was a legendary store of also what people would call streetwear. Now, Nom de Guerre was incredible. It was off of Broadway near Atrium in a basement. My friend Angelo worked there, and the work he did there actually later led to his career at Supreme for many years. But I went there one time because they had this Kurt Cobain t-shirt and just a huge picture of Kurt's face. And again, that t-shirt was like $50. It was too expensive for me. So I was like, in my head, I was like, it's been months. It's been like, it's the spring now or the winter. That's probably on, hopefully it's on sale. So I get on the E-train, take it for an hour all the way to the city. And I go to Nome Negera. I'm like, hey, you guys got that Kurt Cobain t-shirt? Because it wasn't out. And there was a one girl that worked there, and she went to the back and brought it out and just gave it to me. So for me being from, I felt like I'm stealing. Like, am I gonna get in trouble? Because for me, like, no one was giving you a discus sweatshirt at Modell's. No one was giving you shit for free. Or at Hot Wax. Hot Wax off Jamaica Ave, where I used to buy records. They weren't giving you no free records. Matter of fact, they charge you more if you wanted to buy the record a week early. Or like, they'd have, if the record came out on Tuesday, they'd have it on Thursday. So you get to have it for the weekend and bump it. And they charge you more. They charge you $20 instead of $15. So like, getting this free stuff, you know what I mean? But again, forget the fact that it was free. It was like people putting images, copy, words, lyrics, colors, things on clothing from the life that we were living in real time. So many examples of that, you know? There's a couple pieces I still have, and one of them is super influential in my work. Like there's this brand called Sir, ran by this guy named Russ. And he did this thing where he did an M65 and a sweatshirt. And one sweatshirt was Black Jesus, one sweatshirt was White Jesus. And you could buy whichever one you wanted to buy, whatever, right? And to me, I was like, fuck, this is like an art concept. This is not just clothing. This is like creating a conversation. It's also even creating a choice. And it's creating a conversation.
You get to vote.
You get to vote. And then when you wear it, there's, if you get the Black Jesus one, there's a visceral reaction, negative, positive, whatever, wearing that. And I bought the Black Jesus one. My man Vito held it for me until it went on sale. And that's the first thing I ever got from Union. And I remember wearing that on a train, whether I was walking by some Israelites or this or that person, old Black ladies, white people, but people just would comment on it, right? Because it wasn't normal to see something like that on clothing, something that was had that type of statement on it, you know?
It was confrontational.
Yeah. And what I found interesting about it was the statement was not clear. For all we know, Russ could be like, this is a joke. This is comedy.
We don't know. We have no idea.
But because he left it ambiguous.
Yeah.
Then you get all these reactions for people.
It becomes more about the viewer than it becomes about the art.
Exactly.
The art is the starter of the conversation.
Exactly.
But it doesn't finish it.
And I held on to that piece of sweatshirt. That shirt went from Jamaica, Queens to Greenpoint, Brooklyn, where I lived. And then I moved to London. Mark Jacobs, I was a sales associate there. Started off as a stock guy. They moved me to London, to LA, back to New York. Literally, over the course of 20 years, that sweatshirt is one of my talisman. Because there's certain items I've collected. I mean, I have a lot of stuff in general, but there's this certain couple items that were like, I keep them for reasons beyond aesthetics. Of how it looks in my house or on my body, what it makes me think about.
What was your first job in fashion?
My first job was a sales associate at J. Crew in the year 2000, not far from the Virgin Records over by 14th Street. That's where I used to spend my lunch break, going in there listening to music.
So much of today's life happens on the web. Squarespace is your home base for building your dream presence in an online world. Designing a website is easy, using one of Squarespace's best-in-class templates. With the built-in style kit, you can change fonts, imagery, margins, and menus, so your design will be perfectly tailored to your needs. Discover unbreakable creativity with Fluid Engine, a highly intuitive drag-and-drop editor. No coding or technical experience is required. Understand your site's performance with in-depth website analytics tools. Squarespace has everything you need to succeed online. create a blog, monetize a newsletter, make a marketing portfolio, launch an online store. The Squarespace app helps you run your business from anywhere. Track inventory and connect with customers while you're on the go. Whether you're just starting out or already managing a successful brand, Squarespace makes it easy to create and customize a beautiful website. Visit squarespace.com/tetra and get started today.
Did everyone who worked in the stores that you've mentioned, were they all club kids?
Damn, that's a good, great question. And yeah, that was the thing. Club kids was like, work retail. Why? Not because you made a lot of money, but you could have that late shift. So you could be out all night, still get some sleep. And you know, because there's the two shifts. So there's a JQ shift where like you come in at one and you work like 1 to 8 or something like that, or like 12 to eight. So that was a part of it. No, loads of club kids worked retail. That was always the thing, even before my era, probably a couple eras before that, you know? Yeah, worked at J. Crew, then worked at Bergdorf Goodman as a stock guy in Saks. Then went back, worked at Grady's Liquor Store in my old, in Jamaica, Queens. And then got a job at Kate Spade, stock guy. And then I got the job at Marc Jacobs, which that was the first job of my life that I wanted.
The others were jobs to support yourself. And then Marc Jacobs was the start of what you wanted to do.
Yeah. That's the first job I wanted that I got. I wanted to work at Union, but Marriott, they wouldn't hire me. Yeah. But yeah, got the job at Marc Jacobs. And I remember I got that job. I knew it would change my life because I knew it was a place of confluence. And I knew from reading books that if you hang around places that have the same values or the things that you're into and the people that care about the same stuff you care about, hang around, stuff can happen.
Yeah, opportunities arise.
Yeah.
Like-minded community.
And it trickled down from Mark because he's a cool dude. And he's a club kid. He was hanging out at Studio 54 area. Working, you know, he started off working at retail. I forget the name of the store, Uptown, which is also the same store where he sold his first pieces of clothing, was the same store he was a stock guy at.
Wow.
So, you know, I was obsessed with Marc Jacobs clothing, and I thought he was a cool character. You know what I mean? I thought he seemed like a cool dude from the tidbits of information I can get on him from magazines. So I used to always go to the Marc Jacobs collection store and like check out the clothing. Yeah, I got lucky. A very cool person by the name of Hadara. She reached out and I hadn't seen her. I first met her. So here's the thing. I first met her at the store Union years before. And then I remember I ran into her. We were talking. She's like, sorry, I want to talk with you, but I got to run. I got to go to Shabbos. And I imagine her seeing me might have put me in her mind and sent me an email like, hey, would you be interested in interviewing at Marc Jacobs? And my other friend, Adam, had tried to get me a job there. It didn't work. I didn't even get an interview. And then Hadar had just become manager there, I think, or something. And she got me an interview. And then I had three interviews with Debbie, who was the store manager, Susie, who was the head of HR, and then Robert Duffy, who started the company with Marc Jacobs. He was the president in 1985. And, you know, Robert was so deep, he interviewed every person.
Wow.
I was interviewing for the stock position.
Wow.
And he was the president of Marc Jacobs.
It tells you a lot about the care in the company. If the head of the company meets every single employee, it's an unusual company.
Exactly. Yeah. That care reflected in the staffing and the music. They let us play whatever music we wanted at the store, which was unheard of.
Yeah.
In retail. We're playing Lil Wayne mixtapes or people playing Peaches, Fuck the Pain Away. You know what I mean? Like, we're playing all kinds of stuff there. It was funny. That always requires arguments, though, within the staff. Because people were fighting for that iPod time. You know what I mean? People wanted to put their music on. But it was fun because I learned so much more. That took my music knowledge to the next level.
just because it was a wide variety of people playing music.
Yeah, because it was this amazing blender of kids who were from New York or moved to New York. Club kids, art kids, you know? That's the first time I met artists was working at Marc Jacobs. You know, people that, whether they went to art school or self-taught artists. I mean, my dad's an artist, but I didn't even realize my dad was an artist. I'm like, look, my dad's like, he's a cameraman, it's a technical job. He's an artist. But far as me meeting someone the same age as me, that's the first time I ever met artists. You know, that was 2006. So I was already in my early 20s. That's the first time I met someone who made stuff that wasn't music.
When you're a kid, you don't meet artists.
Nah.
You know, it's interesting. You think it's this rare breed of person that's different. And it's not. We're just not around them.
We're just not around them, exactly. And so I was meeting these kids who make art, all types of different types of art. I remember my friend, he's still my friend to this day. He was at my wedding. One of my best friends, James Corrigan. He's from Boston, was a graffiti writer. Now he's a musician. But we had the Secret Santa. So this is my first year at Marc Jacobs. So he pulled out my name and he bought me the autobiography of Miles Davis. And that changed my life, reading that book. I never read a book so fast. And once I got out of New York, I took that book, and that was another one of my talismans.
Yeah.
I took that book with me wherever I went, even when I traveled for a long time. It was like my Linus blanket, because Miles is dynamic, as you know, dynamic character. But I learned so much from that book about trusting your gut. And it was like, that book gave me my Spidey sense. Because I read the autobiography of Miles Davis when I met certain friends / mentors, I was like, I got to hang out on this guy. My Spidey sense started tingling.
Yeah.
This is like when Miles met Gil Evans. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
This is my version of Gil Evans.
Yes.
I got to hang out with this guy and do stuff with him.
Yes.
So that book, you know, I read through it. And it's interesting because my dad always told me to read autobiographies. He said that, Tremaine, if you want to figure out where to go in life, you should read autobiographies, not because it'll tell you what to do, but it'll show you what you just said. These people seem so grandiose and special. They're just humans. They go through the same things. Maybe they got lucky. Maybe they seized the opportunity.
Yeah.
Whatever it is, but you see like, oh, this isn't as far as I think it is. And not about, and not the fame, not the money.
No.
Doing.
The art part.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. And the fact that you didn't pick the book, that it was given to you, it's interesting, you know? It's like the fact that you had tried to get the job at Marc Jacobs and didn't get it when you tried.
Yeah.
But then you get a call from a friend.
Like
the universe plays a role in all these things that happen where
something. Yeah, yes, definitely.
Something's
yeah.
going on. It's not like we have to make it happen. It doesn't work that way.
Well, that's
so much of it's out of our control.
No, it's straight up. And you know, that's the thing where I got really fortunate. And I'm grateful to this day with my parents. And I'll keep always, as long as I live, go back to them. Because my dad used to, I'd be brushing my teeth in the bathroom. He'd walk in the bathroom and be like, there's an art to brushing your teeth, Tremaine. There's an art to everything. Trust me. And he'd walk out the bathroom.
Dad sounds like a Buddhist monk.
A little bit, yeah. Nah, a little bit. Or like he used to sit me down and have me watch Joseph Campbell with him.
Wow.
Power of Myth.
Beautiful.
Whenever that was on PBS.
Yeah.
He never made me do things. Yeah.
He invited
me. You know, and then we talk about the hero's journey. My dad having me watch Joseph Campbell when I'm a teenager, and then me as a young man getting the book from James, and then me knowing about the hero's journey, and then I'm like, I see the hero's journey in Miles' life, and then I see that everyone lives the hero's journey. It's not about if you become this great jazz player. Garbage man, whatever your walk of life is, it's all important and it's all meaningless, equally meaningless. And we all have a journey and it's different. Like part of hero's journey is when you meet the mentor. Everyone's gonna meet the mentor whether you want to listen and humble yourself to be an apprentice, that's going to change your journey. It just is. You know what I mean? And, you know, for me, there was a couple of people. One of them was my friend A-Side, you know. Hadara was a mentor, too. I learned a lot about art from her. You know, like, I learned a little bit about art from my parents. And, you know, they had, like, Andy Warhol's diary on their bookshelf next to, like, James Baldwin, The Fire Next Time. And I read and looked at those books and then started hanging out with H. We became friends and started dating after that through working together at Marc Jacobs. And, you know, she taught me a lot about art and exposed me to a lot of things that I wasn't exposed to, you know what I mean? And, you know, so she was a friend slash mentor for a time. And then to this day, you know, my boy A-Side, he's a friend slash mentor and learned so much about music, life, and really maybe the best thing I learned from A-Side is like willpower, just seeing the things he's gone through and to be where he's at now, you know? So that was another amazing thing too, is like me being given these things and not taking them for granted. Cause I treated Marc Jacobs and Robert moving me to London to work at the Marc Jacobs collection store, I treated getting that book from James the same way.
Was it your first time in London when you got the job?
It was first time out of America, never had a passport.
And what was that experience like?
Incredible, man. They moved me to London in 2010. I lived there till almost 2018.
Wow, I didn't know that.
Yeah, probably when we first met each other, I was still transversing between London and LA.
I see.
And I worked for Marc Jacobs from 2006 to 2015. I started off at the England Greenwich Village, West Village store, ended up in the Mount Street store.
Always on the retail side?
Yeah, always on the retail side. And London was great, man. It took my knowledge of culture, it expanded it. It just expanded my world, you know. My world, man. Just learned so much there, you know, and I still employ things I've learned from my time in London and the stuff I make and also just my life. You know, it's so different because, like, okay, America's great, but if you drive or get on a plane for an hour and a half, you're in, like, Philly. And Philly's a great town. Whereas if you get on a plane or drive for an hour and a half in London, you're in Italy or you're in Paris on the Eurostar. So it was affordable, and I'd squeeze the hell out of my weekends and vacations.
You could also get on a train and go anywhere fast.
And also, you got 6 weeks of vacation.
Yeah.
Where in America, you start off with like 4 days or a week.
Yeah.
You had to earn up and you could top out at 2 weeks. Mm-hmm. Where customary, off rip in Europe, you get 6 weeks. But then besides that was meeting A-Side.
Tell me about A-Side. I don't know anything about him.
One of my best friends, and just he's a musician, producer, DJ, and he's hilarious. And he's just like one of the most well-read people I've ever met in my life. And he's just like a potluck of knowledge and style. You know, you used to meet some people and they're like, okay, they're all aesthetic. Where A-Side is like, yeah, I'm really into punk and Vivian Westwood and all that stuff. But then also I read Please Kill Me in all those books and all those things too. So it's not just like the look, it's the thing that made the look that he researches intensely. You know, he owns 10,000 records. Like any great DJ owns, I've noticed this thing, every great DJ owns, that's the thing, you own 10,000 of the right records. Yeah, we met at a party and he was smoking a cigar and I smoked cigars, and I never saw people in my age bracket smoke cigars. So that's why I just went up to him and said, oh, I never really. Also, as I was new in London, I'm like, those are Cubans. So you can't really get Cubans in America legally, where you can in London. I was like, oh, you smoking a Cuban? He's like, yeah. And then he's like, yeah, I just came back. I was visiting Cuba, and he gave me a Cuban cigar, took my number. And that's how we became friends. And I remember, the first time we hung out, came to this place. I was just astounded by the way his place looked and all the books and records he had. And I remember he gave me he did a thing with the artist Chris Ofili. They did a charity thing. So they had some leftover artworks that Chris had done for the charity. I knew who Chris Ofili was because of the Sensation show in Brooklyn that Giuliani tried to shut down, where it was Chris Ofili, Damien Hirst, all these artists. And he did the Madonna with the cow dung on it.
The point about going to somebody's place and seeing their record collection and book collection and how you feel, like, it makes sense for me to be friends with this person.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, he lives in a way different than many people, but in a way that you would feel comfortable living.
Exactly, exactly. I think you become friends with people that remind you of the positive things from your childhood, but also maybe show you the opportunities that you didn't have or see or knew were possible in your childhood. So it's the thing in the past and the future.
Yeah.
And that's usually the people that I think become your best friends or mm-hmm. mentors you become tight with. And and ASICS gave me this thing, and it was just like, this is 2010. I'm a sales associate at Marc Jacobs, and someone's given me something, not just of value, but like meaningful to them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Chris Ofili's amazing artist. And it was like just something people didn't do. You know what I mean? People just didn't just do stuff just to do it. Like, there's no angle, you know? And that was interesting to me. And we became friends. And then like a year later, he said to me once, hey, I think if I DJ and you host the parties, it could be good. Because he said what made him want to do that was one day he came to hang out with me at Marc Jacobs, and a customer came in, and he said, he's observing, she seemed quite like staunch or like quite curt. And he said, by the end of me working with her, he said, I totally, like, I don't know, this is his opinion, broken her down. And she's like, Tremaine, can't wait to come see you again, this and the third. He's like, this guy's be a good partner for me in doing stuff. So we started doing parties, and honestly, everything I do now, creatively, business-wise, the seed of it was, besides like other stuff before meeting ASICS, but also me and him connecting and doing those parties. Through that, during those parties, I became friends and met and started working with Serge Becker, working with Frank Ocean, became friends with Virgil, Benji B, Jude and Benji B from Deviation. I met Kaius my first week in London, became friends. So that's what happened in London. I met all these really good people, but also culturally astute people. So they were just great, decent human beings, but also had cultural depth. You know, my friend Graham Erickson, the list goes on. You know, Martine Rose, Grace Wells Bonner, so many people. London was just like, I really cut my teeth far as jettisoning from working retail.
Yeah.
You know, I worked retail from age 19, 20 to age 33, 34. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Do you think it had a positive effect? Working retail, did that inform your understanding of the world?
Yeah, I think it did. It was great. One of the main things was the bookmark. The bookstore that Marc Jacobs and Robert started, when I worked in the West Village, the bookstore was there, and I would hang out there on my lunch breaks and stuff like that. I never worked there as a sales associate. And Jim Baker, who was the curator for the bookstore, just had amazing books, man. I learned so much. You know, a lot of them I didn't buy because I didn't have the money back then. But I remember all of them. And I buy them now. I'm continuously buying all the books I didn't buy from the bookmark store. When I moved to London, there was a little bookmark section there. Matter of fact, Frank, on that Blonded Radio, the Iceman episode, mm-hmm. he has a freestyle, and he sings about that time in London, me and him hanging out. Frank would come to the store, and we'd hang out and just be kicking it in front of the books and going through the books and stuff like that. Then after I get off work, he'd wait for me to get off work, and we'd go hang out at Scott's, the fish restaurant, and eat. And then sometimes the conversation would continue that we're having in the book section of the Marc Jacobs store. You know, this is back in 2000, 13, 12, when me and him, Matt, became cool. And then I started working with him on Boys Don't Cry magazine and Blonde. Yeah, the working in retail, the best part was those books.
That's it.
But then also just the people I met.
Welcome to the House of Macadamias. Macadamias are a delicious superfood, sustainably sourced directly from farmers. Macadamias, a rare source of omega-7, linked to collagen regeneration, enhanced weight management, and better fat metabolism. Macadamias, heart healthy and brain boosting fats. Macadamias, paleo friendly, keto and plant based. Macadamias, no wheat, no dairy, no gluten, no GMOs, no preservatives, no palm oil, no added sugar. House of Macadamias, dry roasted with Namibian sea salt, cracked black pepper, and chocolate dipped. Snack bars come in chocolate, coconut white chocolate, and blueberry white chocolate. Visit houseofmacadamias.com/tetra.
You feel like you got any understanding of the consumer, or was it not about that?
Yeah, I became a pretty good sales associate, but what I think set me apart from your typical sales associate, and not just me, other people too at Marc Jacobs compared to other stores, the era of retail, which is very different than the era of retail now. I tell a woman, you shouldn't buy that dress.
Yeah, it's not for you.
That's what I learned.
Yeah.
And people respect that.
Because you're honest, and it's so rare.
And you might make less money commission that day, but you end up having a customer.
Because you're credible.
Yeah, exactly. So, man, I just saw Mark on the design side, him and his team, take so many chances season after season. He had his motifs that he went back to, but he'd do left turns and...
Would you say fearless creatively?
Yeah, I believe so. Fearless. And there'd be shows that he were heralded. There'd be shows that he was panned. And he just kept it moving.
Yeah.
You know, and I think he didn't bask in the applause.
Yep.
And he didn't soak in the booze.
Mm-hmm.
And I learned that from watching him and his team. I saw him use the keys to the house at Louis Vuitton and in his own company, Marc Jacobs, to put forth the things he loved in culture through the clothing to people. So it felt like sharing. I remember the first Marc Jacobs show I went to at the Armory, Sonic Youth was just playing in the middle of the show with the models walking around. Now you see that all the time. But back then, 2006, that wasn't the typical thing for a fashion show. It was just cool as fuck. After parties always be dope. Like, I remember one after party had Diplo and MIA DJing and performing. But it was before either one of them blew. It was just like right there. And I was just always so, I took so many notes. Also having the high low, having, you know, when you put intention into something, so if there's a little plastic coin purse that costs $25, or if it's a chinchilla coin purse that costs $2,500. But if you put the intention to it, they're actually worth the same thing. And they cost different prices because of what it costs to make them and markups and all that stuff. But actually the intention makes them equal. And the customer, you can actually teach the customer that and guide the customer that you can buy this thing and this thing. And neither is better. It's just...
The quality is in both of them.
Yeah.
One just has a different material.
Exactly. And, you know, I saw Mark do that thing, that high-low thing, through different categories and different things. Even like something that's quite customary now is brands doing collaborations. Then when he wasn't the first to do it, and I think he might have caught that from hanging out in Japan, but was like Marc Jacobs and like collaborations with like Vans or other things. You know, those were huge back in the day, back in like 2005 and 4, the Vans collab. And just also seeing the thing, my favorite thing to do, and I've learned from seeing other artists do it, is putting the right thing in the wrong place. You know, putting the right thing in a place that people wouldn't expect to see it.
Changing the context around something.
Yeah. Yeah.
To make it something new.
Make it something new. And you actually don't even know what it will become, you know? So, yeah, definitely working at MJ, learned so much. Also at my other gigs too, learned a lot. The customer knows when you're sure of yourself. Even they might not even be able to enunciate that. It's something maybe subconscious, but they know.
And sure yourself is interesting because when you sure yourself, it's only what you think. It doesn't mean you're right, but you're true to yourself.
Yeah, like people ask me, let's say I put out something, a collection or something, and people will leave in comments they don't like it or do like it. Almost 99% of the time, I don't respond to either. Not saying I'm some stoic and it doesn't affect me, but in the end, I don't control how you feel about it after I make it.
Yeah, and you're making the thing you want to make. You're not making it really for them. You're making it for you.
Exactly.
And they can go for the ride or not. That's up to them.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly, you know.
It has nothing to do with you, really, how they react.
Yeah, because art isn't like a boxing match where, like, if you knock someone out, it's like, even if they didn't want you to win, you knock the person out. You won the fight. Art's more so like when it goes the distance. And the judges are like, who won? Or Ali or Frazier. It's all interpretation, you know, like Ali, if he didn't knock out George Foreman, maybe he probably would have lost that fight.
Probably so.
On points.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, he got beat up the whole fight.
Fight, yeah, that's what I'm saying. He got beat up the whole, exactly.
Yeah.
So it's kind of like similar to that with making stuff. And that's why artists should be remiss to not get caught up in the validation index, you know.
How do you think you learned that?
I've learned that over time. Again, my mom and dad, always very grateful and lucky, telling me, like, do not care what people think. My dad, mom used to tell me, filter even what we say and choose what's right for you.
Wow.
So, but I have to keep reminding myself that because
it's real wisdom.
The world we live in can take you away from that. Mm-hmm. So you have to keep, it's a practice. None of these things, these totems that I've built in my mind, they're not permanent. They're only permanent if I practice them.
Yeah.
And
it's easy to slip into the mind meld going on outside of ourselves if we're not careful.
Yeah. An example of that is someone who reminded me of that was Yasin, formerly known as Mos Def. We're talking about, I did a collection based off Alvin Ailey. And I worked with his estate and licensed images and copy. And Yasin called me. He's like, yo, man, I'm really proud of you. I love this collection you've done. I said, yeah, man, I did it to, like, because the world needs to know. People should know about Alvin Ailey as much as they know about Michael Jordan. And then Yasin's like, how do you know that was his validation index? World acknowledgement on the level of a Michael Jordan. Maybe he was happy with just the people who were into his art were into it, and the people that weren't, weren't. And he stopped me dead in my tracks on the phone. I was like, yo, you're right. So I don't need to do the collection so that more everyone knows and thinks of Alvin Ailey is important and see him in the light they need to be seen in. I just need to do it because I think he's great.
That's it. And that's all you can do.
That's it, you know?
It's like, this is what's interesting to me.
Yeah, and once you get into the trying to push the thing,
it becomes something else.
It's something else, and it kind of taints it.
Absolutely.
For yourself.
It's not pure anymore.
Yeah.
It's not pure anymore.
Yeah.
If it has some, trying to do some work in the world.
Yeah.
Art's not like that. You can make something, and it can take on a political significance in the world, but usually when that happens, it has nothing to do with what your intention was in making it.
Yeah.
That happens if it's meant to happen.
You know.
You can't control that because otherwise it feels like it's propaganda. It's something else.
Yeah. you know, I design many things, but there's this one piece of design that's quite popular, and it's a cotton reef. And there's a loud minority of people who are saying, oh, this is profiting off of black trauma. And then there's people who are saying they think it's beautiful, right? And they think this is amazing. But my truth and my intention was, it makes me feel good.
That's it.
Because for me, I'm like, you know, I see in other cultures, like let's say like certain cultures, they have like a family crest, a symbol or words. And that crest might have things from where the family comes from. Let's say like something Celtic, and like they were farmers or they were masons or whatever. That might be in the crest or something like that. So for me, I'm like, everyone in my family's first job was picking cotton. And before that, when we were slaves, we picked cotton. That was one of the things slaves were used to do, to pick cotton. And that's the thing that built this country and built capitalism. And then it's like Joseph Campbell, the word religio. Religion comes from the word Latin word religio, which is the return to. And he speaks a lot about the circle, the returning to, even a wedding ring. That's why people wear wedding rings, the connecting, you know, all that. And it all was starting connecting to me. And I start making these different art pieces, static art pieces. Cotton reef, black Jesus, black Madonna, working with the Pan-African flag, flipping polo motifs to put the black gaze on something someone would call a white institution, put the black gaze on it. I was making all these things. And then, you know, I said, oh, you know, I'm gonna make a clothing line and I'm gonna take these art pieces and apply them to stuff.
But that came second. Started with the art.
Yeah.
Just made the art.
But the thing is,
did you make the art with an idea of showing it or just to make it?
I showed it a couple times. Like I showed it in London with this artist and someone who's become a good friend, Theaster Gates. He had a thing doing frieze and I showed the reef, and actually it was a coffin that was covered with the Pan-African flag, which was done by David Hammons in 1990, which was based off Marcus Garvey's Pan-African flag from 1920. So I made a version of it. I had a coffin built and put the coffin with the flag over it and then the reef on top of the coffin. And yeah, that's one of my first pieces I made and showed it in London. And then Virgil's mid-career show in Atlanta Art Institute, we had a collaborative piece, and then I had a piece of work called Demo One that I showed there. And then I actually got a couple pieces of the clothing stuff in the Met permanent collections.
Wow. But so cool.
Yeah.
But the clothing came after the art.
After, yeah.
Inspired by, almost like the merch for the art.
Exactly. I was making the pieces. And even now, whenever I have a new collection or new thing, I build it in my head on mood boards, sometimes physically, as an art project. The whole Denim Tears thing is an art project. And I just felt that clothing was to get the ideas out. I just felt the art world, it's like, it's cool and I appreciate it.
Too removed?
Too removed, too limited, you know? Like the last 2 years they do this thing called Farmer's Day. So me and Andy drove down there, saw a bunch of old friends. You've probably seen it before. You know the rock on Farmers Boulevard, that red, black, and green rock? You know it. And LLs take legendary pictures in front of there. They do a barbecue around there. It's a big block party around the rock. They've been doing it the last 2 years. So I went, I had missed it the first couple years. I went with Andy and we're hanging out. My man Smart came and met us and I was like, let's get some food. And the line was super long to get food from the barbecue. So I was like, hey, we're gonna go over about 40 projects to this fish spot. So we're driving along the white wall and I see a kid wearing these jeans I did. And that was the whole point. The fact that I'm seeing a young man wearing a pair of jeans in my old neighborhood, I couldn't get that.
That you made.
That I made. I couldn't get that from the art world.
Yeah.
I get it on someone's wall.
Yeah, it's
but
different.
But that guy.
It's different.
That guy that owned the art piece, he'd have to transverse all. He'd have to transverse all the worlds I've transversed.
Yeah.
To even like maybe be able to afford or even know. Forget the money. It's just about if you know, that's the first step to acquiring something.
Yes.
Or acquiring knowledge.
Yes.
So yeah, just seeing that young dude on his four-wheeler.
It's also kind of a punk rock idea or hip hop idea as well of like taking it out of the conservatory.
Yeah.
And bringing it back to the street. It's like, this is where we are. This is ours. It's for us. This is not meant to be in an institution. It could be there too. You know, when something related to hip hop ends up in an institution, it's always interesting to me, but that's not why it was made.
Yeah, Jay-Z didn't write those lyrics and make those songs to end up at the Brooklyn Library.
No.
It's cool that it did.
It's cool that it did, but that's not what it's about.
Yeah.
That's not what, it you was know? Never about that.
Yeah, you know, he had to get the stuff out of his head.
Mm-hmm.
And he wanted to get out the streets, but he also still wanted to do something that meant something to him.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, he had this talent that he developed. It's like if you watch Star Wars, yeah, you could be born with the Force, but you have to develop it. You have to work your ass off. Not even just work your ass off, become fearless.
Yeah.
Because the strongest Jedis are the fearless ones, not the ones who train the most.
Yeah.
Not the ones who are the fastest or the strongest. It's the strongest artists are the ones that lack the most amount of fear. Not the ones that went to Yale for painting. I'm not knocking that. One of my favorite painters went to Yale for painting.
Mm-hmm.
Jennifer Packer. But I'm saying, in the end, what really makes an artist great is how much fear do you lack? And a lot of the fear for artists starts coming in once the success happens. Or if the success doesn't happen. So that's the funny thing about success and not having success.
Yeah.
It can give you the same thing.
Yeah.
If you don't have the success.
You react. Either way, you react instead of acting.
Yeah. So you can be like, okay, I'm making stuff and I'm fearless. It's working. Damn. Should I keep making the same old stuff? Because I don't want to not keep being successful. You let fear creep in and you're going to get weaker. If you're making stuff and it's not selling, or you're not getting the validation or attention you want, oh, maybe I should start making different stuff. Maybe I should make stuff like the guy, like Jeff Koons, because he's successful. You're letting fear creep in and you're getting weaker. It's the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
And fear, being fearless doesn't mean you don't feel fear. It's just knowing that you have to walk through it.
And
you know?
Knowing that your purpose is to express yourself. That's what it is. It's about self-expression. This is the thing I want to make.
Yeah.
Check it out.
Yep. And that applies to everything.
Yeah.
Who you partner with. It's all choice. And not letting those choices be tainted by the judgments of the tribe.
Yeah, or expectations.
Expectations of the tribe.
What may fall within the sphere of tetragrammaton? Counterculture?
Tetragrammaton.
Sacred geometry?
Tetragrammaton.
The avant-garde?
Tetragrammaton.
Generative art?
Tetragrammaton.
The tarot?
Tetragrammaton.
Out-of-print music?
Tetragrammaton.
Biodynamics?
Tetragrammaton.
Graphic design?
Tetragrammaton.
Mythology
and magic?
Tetragrammaton.
Obscure film?
Tetragrammaton.
Beach culture?
Tetragrammaton.
Esoteric lectures.
Tetragrammaton.
Off the grid living.
Tetragrammaton.
Alt spirituality.
Tetragrammaton.
The canon of fine objects.
Tetragrammaton.
Muscle cars.
Tetragrammaton.
Ancient wisdom for a new age.
Upon entering, experience the artwork of the day. Take a breath and see where you are drawn.
When did you first feel like you found your tribe?
I think I first felt like that hanging out at Union.
Other people who were different from everyone else, but more like you.
Yeah. You're hanging out at Union, and then my friend, you know, my friend Nigel and my friend Dre from my neighborhood, and they're both older than me. Because they definitely saw me. They saw me for But I remember one of my friends, they're like, yo, you be hanging out in the village and stuff and hanging out downtown. You know there's gay people there. Like super provincial, like just like, you know, yo, there's gay people down there. I was like, and?
So?
I don't care. Like, I have no problem. Issue with homosexuals. You know what I mean? I don't even consider them. They're humans. I don't even see, like, I don't even delineate. It's interesting the myths that humans create. That's what separates us from other animals. Humans' ability to create myths, right? And so, like, I remember my friend was like, man, I don't hang out in the city because the food's more expensive there. I'm like, not everywhere. You know, like, there's a place called Lovely Day that I'd go to. I said, I spend less money at Lovely Day than you guys spend at BBQ's, and the food's better for me. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And he's like, yeah, well, they charge more money at the Gap out there. I'm like, no, my girlfriend, Kenya, she works at the Gap. The prices are the same across. But he's creating this myth because of this fear that he has of being out of Jamaica, Queens, you know? And that's something I learned about from my parents because they didn't have that fear. You know, my dad told me about one of his fishing buddies. The only time that guy left Long Island was when his wife got sick. He said, I don't mess with the city. I don't mess with. And I was always just like, I found it really interesting. It's a choice, though.
Absolutely.
People that just stay where they're at when they don't have to and not see other things or learn other things. So I say that to say those were my brothers and my friends, but I met them through circumstance of moving there. Because there were other people I could hang out with. So we chose each other, but there was a wall for me. Because they were afraid to go and experience other things, whether it be food, music, people, and I wasn't. So that put a limit on how far our friendship could go, in my opinion. Not how far our friendship could go, but just like the time we could spend. Because I'm not gonna not go there because you're trying to make me afraid of hanging out in the village or hanging out in Soho or hanging out anywhere. So that's why when I went to Union, especially when I met guys like Angelo and Wilkins, they were guys from the outer boroughs. Now all the kids come and hang out downtown. That wasn't a thing. We all hung out and met up there. And so if you saw someone that dressed like you, or look like you downtown, you'd be like, what's up? Because you know they transverse the same terrain to get there. You literally, far as sitting on a train for an hour, and if you're gonna hang out late, you're gonna be on that train for an hour and a half, or waiting for that train for an hour to get back to Queens. But also psychologically transversing the terrain of like your tribe, maybe being like, why are you going out there? Who do you think you are? You know, so yeah, that was the first time the tribe was hanging out at Union, I think, me and Catch over there.
Tell me the story of Denim Tears.
Well, the story goes back to the name came from an inside joke. Just it's back in like 2013 or 14, me, Virgil, A-Side, Benji B, Caius, and Sam Ross were at a dinner before. There was this club, there was this place called Addition Hotel. So the Addition, first hotel they opened, I think, was in London. And this guy named Seb Chu, A&R dude, an amazing, legendary London DJ, he ran a night in the basement at the Addition. So at that time, what we'd do is, if V was in Paris, I'd hit V like, yo, they'll get your Eurostar ticket and pay you £200 to DJ, whatever, right? Whenever you were using Paris or something. And then I'd be like, yo, Benji, got V coming out, ASAP, V's coming out. Let's do a night. Like, even we had a crew, it was called US Still. So anyway, they give us a free dinner. So we were having dinner before the gig. I had this pair of 1954 Repro Levi's denim that I bought when I first moved to London. Because when I first moved to London, my moving bonus was a month's paycheck. So I bought this really expensive pair of denim. with that money, and I wore them every day for years. So they eventually got torn and ripped to shit, and then...
I've seen you wear those.
Yeah.
I've seen them torn.
Yeah, you've seen them. So I posted this thing on Instagram where I would just post images of things, and because people post selfies, right? And I always thought it was quite funny, like you're posting a picture of yourself. But cool. So I was trolling, so I'd post things that gave the emotion of what I was feeling, but not a picture of me. It'd be different things, and I just hashtag selfie. So it was always, and it always would be things that only five people understood the joke or the emotion. So I posted those jeans, the back pocket looked like something. So then at the dinner, ASICS and Caius, or Caius and Virgil, they brought up that post. And they're like, yeah, you posted the ripped denim. And then someone said like your denim was crying or something like that. And then maybe Caius or someone, or ASICS said Denim Tears. And I said, oh, that sounds like an R&B group. So we're just cracking jokes. So then the next day, Virgil wrote, he had a blog on style.com where he would recap his travels. So he wrote like, yeah, and we had dinner and we had a party with Caius Paulson of Young Turks fame, Benji B of Deviation fame, ASICS of Nike marketing. He had this night he used to do, and he wrote that. And then he said, and then Denim Tears of Marc Jacobs fame. He's just trolling me. We're joking.
Yeah.
And so then from that moment, I just changed my handle. So when we did parties, I put Denim Tears. So it would be me and ASICS doing parties, or Virgil, Pyrex Vision, ASICS, and Denim Tears. So it started from that. But then the way my mind works is like, okay, inside joke. And then I was like, Denim Tears, that kind of human experience is kind of like a pair of jeans. You start off brand new, and then the attrition of life makes rips, and physically and psychologically. So then I was like, oh, that's what Denim Tears means now. So I gave it a different meaning. So then it meant like the human condition. And so Denim Tears, the brand, is about a part of the human condition, which is the plight and glory of the African diaspora. You know, some of the stories I tell about are about the history of cotton, some of the stories about Alvin Ailey, some of the stories about Windrush. I mean, I designed a collection based off, there's this dude, he had a tiger in his apartment in Harlem. You ever heard that story?
No.
There's a dude.
No.
In the mid-2000s, he had a tiger in his apartment in Harlem named Ming. And this guy was obsessed with animals, and he raised a full-grown tiger in his apartment. And then it was the biggest stories in New York that year. So I'm like, okay, what am I going to design the next collection about? So there's like great imagery I can create off that. But also that's just an interesting story. Like, it's a story of a guy in the hood with a tiger. That's insane and also amazing. And I talked to the guy, interviewed him, and designed a whole collection based off that, about him and Ming, Tiger of Harlem. So, yeah. So it's like a zany, you know, I was like, I remember someone texting me, like, I love the Ming collection. I'm like, yeah, I tell zany black stories too. You know what I mean? So, because that's a zany ass story. You know, I got a collection coming out called Kiss My Grits, which is what my mom used to tell me when I annoy her. She'd be like, Kiss My Grits. The collection is about black food. About the foods I grew up eating in Harlem, Georgia, and in New York.
Tell me the scale of a collection. How small can it be, and how big can it be?
It could be like, you know, like my collection I did with Dior. There's probably 50 different items. Maybe not what made it to retail, but like in the show that happened in Egypt, there's probably like 80 items, maybe more. But then there's collections like, I did a collection based off growing up in Jamaica, Queens, and The Rock. With Stüssy, and like that was like the jeans, the jacket, the winter coat, the Scully, the belt, the bag, the sweater. 8 items. And through 8 items, so it's like an album.
Yeah.
You know, so it's like easiest was 10 songs, yeah. You know? But there's a lot in there. But then sometimes there's a double album.
Do you have any sense of it happens on an annual basis, or it's not like that? It's just when you feel it.
So I think because my career started when I was a full-blown adult,
mm-hmm.
But I've been thinking about these things since I was a teenager. I'm just rolling out the ideas.
Because you have a backlog from...
Yeah. And when, you know, probably when that backlog is out, maybe that's when I'll stop doing it. Or there's so many stories. There's so many...
I'm sure they're going to keep coming, too.
Yeah.
Because you're as curious now as you ever was.
So yeah,
I am. Why would it stop?
Yeah. So, but kind of do a fall, winter, spring, summer thing. But I don't wholesale.
So you do 4 collections a year?
Denim Tears is only 4 years old. So, and then, you know, I got sick a year ago. So that put a monkey wrench in it. So it's kind of taken me out of it for like almost a year. But life willing, between 3 and 4 collections a year, internal Denim Tears collections, and then the collaborations around it.
How do you manufacture and how do you sell if you don't wholesale?
I manufacture all around the world. So I make stuff in Japan, make stuff in America, make stuff in China.
And those are relationships you developed over time?
You're only as good as your team. And I'm nothing without my team. There's nothing I've ever done on my own. I have an amazing, amazing production director, a guy named Daniel. We've been working together for about maybe 2.5, 3 years.
What was his background?
He had owned a brand called Simon Miller. He went to art school for graphic design, got into fashion, owned the brand Simon Miller, left it, sold his shares. He's the cousin of the guy that gave James Corrigan, who gave me the Miles Davis book.
Wow.
James hits me up. He said, hey, you know, my cousin Daniel's a really amazing at making clothing. You know me, Tremaine. I wouldn't recommend anyone unless they were of a certain ilk. And so with someone like James recommending Daniel, I was like, we got to meet this guy. And then met him. And he's really helped the brand a lot because he's amazing at, he's an artisan at making clothing.
Okay.
So he helps take my designs and ideas and references, and he helps me bring them to life. And I wouldn't, you know, Denim Tears would be different without him. Just like, you know, Eric films almost all the stuff we do, stills and video. Got about eight people I work with at this point.
Mm-hmm. And how do you sell it?
Online and at Dover Street Market.
And online would be your website?
Website, yeah, denimtears.com. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's
everything is limited run?
It's funny, I don't like the word limited, and I posted something today that I said limited quantity. Anyway, but I make what I can make based off what I feel the demand will be and the funds I have to produce. So as time is going, the brand keeps growing and doing well, I'm able to make more of stuff that I feel that people want to buy a lot of. There's certain stuff that I feel like I'm like, oh, you know, this mohair string vest, maybe not 500 people will want this.
Right.
But it's still very, just it's very important to the line.
Yeah.
So I'm going to make 150 of those.
Yeah.
And then you make an educated decision based off how things do. If you're going to, the next time you make an item of that style, if you buy more or less.
Would you ever repress something if people like it?
Yeah, yeah. Every design is different, but from what I've learned and read, not just in creation, it's like certain things miss people. And then if you step off it too quick, you don't get to get your idea out. So by repressing something, the idea gets to get out.
And there's nothing wrong with it. It's a thing you made, and if more people want it, it's cool that they can have it.
So yeah.
I don't think we're making things with the idea that they're supposed to be impossible to get.
It's like, I want my stuff to be like, okay, like, Killers of the Flower Moon. I just went to see it. We went to go see it a month ago when it first opened. Incredible film. Anyone can go see it, you know? Andy Warhol said, like, I want to be like Coke. Everyone could get a Coke. So anyone can go see Killers of the Flower Moon. And I think that's, to me, that's the highest level, access to everyone. that's what I endeavor towards, you know.
Makes sense. It's like, again, you're not making it with the idea that I'm going to change it so more people will like it. You're making it the way you want it.
Yeah.
And it's once you're signing off on the thing that you love, if more people want it, that seems like a good thing.
Yeah, it is a good thing, and in my opinion. And then also, but you see it a lot in music where it's like, there's a certain sound and you go back to it and you know when to move on from the sound.
Yeah.
And you know when to keep doing it.
What was the first collaboration you did?
The first collaboration I did was with Callie DeWitt and B. Fowler. They had a brand called Somewhere. And I did it was a Somewhere Denim Tears collab. That was like 2016 or 17. And then, yeah, that was my first one. And then my second one was with Online Ceramics. Third was with Levi's. And it just rolled from there. Yeah.
How different is it doing a collaboration versus doing your own stuff?
When it's a collaboration with another creative artist, it's a different dance.
But when it's a collaboration with a brand, it's more like they become the manufacturer and you get to design it?
Yeah, so like, example, I did the Cotton Reef art piece, then converted it into an AI file, and then Levi's reached out to me. They wanted to do a collaboration with me, some denim. So when I went up to San Francisco, I had the sheet of paper with the AI file printed out, and I had it on my phone computer, and I opened my computer and I was like, this is what I want to do. You know? So it's more so when I do a collaboration with the brand, I'm putting different ideas, stories, and or motifs with their products and doing an intervention, you know? So to me, that was interesting. Like, the story I'm telling with this reef and cotton, and then doing it with a brand, denim brand, which obviously uses cotton, that's interesting. And then telling the story through this American brand was interesting. But then also it was interesting of what Levi's stood for. Shout out to Jonathan and Hector. Hector's a guy who put me forward for Levi's. It was pretty unprecedented for them to work with someone like me. I wasn't really known like that. Hector's the one that convinced them to do their collaboration with Virgil. And then I was the next one after that. But I remember Jonathan telling me how Levi's, like in the 80s, during the AIDS epidemic, they're like, if you work there and you had a problem with working with someone, if one of your coworkers had AIDS, they just fire you. Which was unprecedented, because obviously, if you've seen the movie Philadelphia, it was the opposite of that those days. People were pushing people with AIDS away. People were getting fired from their jobs. They were being demonized. So me, when I learned that history about Levi's, I'm like, we're in the same mind state. And also, they were down to do it. They weren't like scared. They weren't like, ooh, this feels controversial. They're just like, this is beautiful. Let's do it. So,
have you ever been censored?
Yeah, I've been censored and, you know, had different situations with different collaborators. Converse, I did a Pan-African flag Converses, and it took a lot to get those out. Originally, a guy named by the name of Curtains, he used to work with Converse and told him the idea. He did it. He was down for it. And I worked with this amazing designer, Amy.
What would be the pushback on that?
They felt that it could be seen as disrespectful to the American flag, putting the Pan-African flag, Pan-African Marcus Garvey's colors on the Pan-African flag that David Hammons did, and doing that on sneakers. They said it felt like it could be disrespectful to the military. The shoes almost got canceled.
And it's interesting to me, because it seems like there are lots of flags.
Yeah.
You know, like.
Exactly.
There's lots of flags, exactly. I wouldn't have guessed that.
You know what's funny thing, too? I said to them, this amazing, one of my favorite designers, this Japanese designer, Takehiro. He used to have a brand called Number 9. Now he has a brand called The Soloist. He put out a sneaker whilst I was working on mine that was American flag, but a black and white one. And I was like, what's the difference, guys? You know, so then it got a bit choppy. we pushed back and forth about it, and then George Floyd happened. You know, I spoke out publicly about my feelings about the support of Converse, of certain movements that were going on during that time. And I was like, oh, I can't really put out this shoe if I don't see more than just donating money. Because intention does more than money. And then they were super responsive and emailed me right away, and we had a great talk, and then we decided to still put out the shoes, and all the money from the shoes went to Black Voters Matter. We donated the first release of the sneakers, donated all the money, and then we worked with this artist, Hank Willis Thomas, to make infographics to try to get people to vote. Not encourage them to vote who they should vote for, but just to get them to vote.
Just to participate.
Participate in states where African Americans didn't normally vote. So that's what the sneaker became representative of. So in the end, we had discourse and it was great.
Yeah. Tell me about the difference between streetwear and luxury fashion.
For me, there's four terms that exist, categories of fashion. Ready to wear, sportswear, couture, and accessories. Streetwear, still waiting for someone to give me a definition of that.
Mm-hmm.
All these years later, I don't personally ascribe to that, that title. Luxury, there's a great book called Deluxe, written by a woman that, I don't know if she still writes for the New York Times, but it says, How Luxury Lost Its Luster.
Mm.
You know, I think one of the only luxury brands that still exists is Hermes.
I love Hermes.
Yeah, same. If you look at the way they go about making the stuff and the intention behind it, you know, that's luxury. You know, Phoebe Philo, she just put out a luxury, her new brand that she just put out, that's luxury. So the difference between luxury and, let's say what I do, ready to wear and sportswear, luxury is artisan base. And it's small quantities, not because you're trying to make it worth more.
You could only make so much.
Yeah.
Because like, there's only so many artisans to make it.
Yeah.
Fine, like, crafted, handmade.
One time I was in Paris with my friend Willow, and we're at this guy Pierre's restaurant, which he's no longer working there anymore. And the food is incredible. And it's like the size of that recording console with tables around it. So 12 people, 16 people could sit. So someone said to Pierre, why don't you franchise this and make more? He says, there's not enough ingredients that are the quality that I make my food with to be able to franchise this. I can't get that many tomatoes of the quality to make what you just ate that you think is so special. So that's what luxury is. It's like, there's only so many of these women or men who are alive that can make this sweater in this way.
Mm-hmm.
And there's only so many people that are apprenticing at it that will be able to do it when these people die.
Yeah, because so, a lot of these skills are getting lost now.
Exactly. So that's what luxury is to me, is items made by artisans based off access to the best materials. Not just materials, the way it's crafted.
Uh-huh.
The man hours
uh-huh.
it takes to stitch or sew something, you know? So that's what luxury is to me. You know, some people can say luxury is desire. So then if that's the case, whatever has desire of said customer is luxury. But for me, luxury is how the thing is made. So I've made a couple items that are luxury, like so a lot of the items in the Dior collection. Like there's this amazing Milner that I got to work with. My highlight of the collection working with Dior was working with Stefan Jones, who's a milliner that works a lot with Kim Jones. He's worked with Mark and other people, and it's just a dad kind of cap, but then it has the Denim Tears, Dior Tears logo, but it's all hand-done work. And I think it took 48 hours or something to make that part of the hat, you know? And it's beautiful. Not just about how long it takes, but it's beautiful handwork. And then that's why it's fun about certain I like certain artists and designers. They take, like, Marc Jacobs has done it. Like, remember Marc Jacobs' collection? He'd always do the cashmere hoodies. It'd be like cashmere mixed with silk. But they were just zip-up hoodies, sweatpants, cut just like old Champion sweatpants, but in cashmere and silk. That's luxury, you know? That's the difference to me.
Tell me about your experience with Supreme. I think the last time I reached out to you was congratulating you on...
Yeah. Yeah, you're like, I like Supreme a lot. Yeah, when I got the job. My experience with Supreme was... learned a lot. Not so much learned a lot working there, but me being in that situation, working at a company that's like gotten that big.
A big corporate company.
That came from the roots of this thing, you know, some would say this thing of ours.
Yeah.
That people call streetwear.
Yes.
Or, you know, sportswear with...
That's funny it's called this thing of ours. I've never heard that.
That's what I call, I'm like, to me, that's what it is. It's this thing of ours, you know.
I've heard that's how the mafia refers to the mafia.
Yeah, to La Cosa Nostra, you know what I mean?
This
like,
thing of ours.
Yeah, but Stüssy, 40 Acres and a Mule, Denim Tears, Supreme, Sir, you know, Fucking Awesome, Babylon, so on and so forth, you know. We're all Nigo, Bape, Human Made. There's a line, you know? The company got sold in a couple of times, and then James fully sold all of it.
Oh, is that true?
Yeah, to VF.
I didn't know.
And when you sell a company, usually the person that bought your brand took a loan out. And there's a thing you call interest. So they took a loan out. There's interest on that loan, and it's just a math problem. How much time you have to make the money back on the loan. And then if you're not making back the money that they spent on top of the interest, you're at a loss and they're poking around. And that changes the intention of making things. So that's one of the main lessons I learned. Also, a lesson I learned is it's not, for me, it's not great working at a company where the founder's still there. That's the creative.
That's interesting.
Yeah, because James is the creative director of Supreme. Then I came in as a creative director, first ever creative director.
Yeah. Did you feel second guessed?
Yeah, I was like creative director in his pocket in the sense of I'll pull out Tremaine's when I want his idea or opinion, but in the end, it's my what I want, which it wasn't presented like that. Mm-hmm. You know, it was presented like, hey, I'm trying to write off it. Ride off into the sunset, and you're going to run the show and work with the team. Because a creative director doesn't do everything. You work with the team. The whole thing is a team sport. So that was difficult, you know, not really being able to make decisions. But then in the media, when numbers come out about how the brand's doing, Tremaine's doing something wrong, where I'm like, James still making the decision. So.
Yeah. Yeah.
But so you're kind of taking the bullets. So then you start to feel like a mascot instead of a
completely
star player, you know? And because that's the thing, it's like LeBron, he's trusted to take that last shot or fake like you're going to take the last shot and pass it like, you know, Jordan would do with John Paxton or Pippen. So it's not always about you taking the last shot, but you're making that decision and working with the coach. Whereas this was like, I'm not making the decision or taking the last shot, but...
But you're taking the blame.
Taking the blame. Yeah. So I learned that there. I was just the outsider there, the way I thought, you know? It's funny. I was like, okay, I'm going to continue the legacy of Supreme, but also modernize it in a way that I think would be meaningful to the people that Supreme wants to be attached to, young people. I don't think that was really understood, you know, completely. But then some things were, so, you know, it didn't work out because then I started just getting put in compromising positions with artists and people I was working with, that we were working with, and then things would change, and then opinions would change, and then it got just really kind of convoluted, in my opinion, my experience there.
Obviously, did you keep Denim Tears going the whole time?
Yeah,
too?
Yeah. Kept Denim Tears. That was part of my contract. You know, James always said Denim Tears is imported. You know, he always said he felt it was one of the best brands out there. Even in the last conversation we had, he said that. It got really difficult there too, because there's like things me and James discuss or we're trying to do, and then his C-suite, which I was a part of, they're trying to mitigate keeping him happy, but also keeping VF happy. And none of it's out in the open, nothing's clear. So now this causes conflict. It's like it's a family.
Yeah.
Right? That's why, you know, all the times I've talked about it, I've compared it to like secession. You know, it's like you got Logan Roy, and then you have people fighting for who's going to get the keys to the throne, which isn't my thing.
Yeah. I think anytime something gets big,
yeah,
it changes. It's just the nature of things getting big. It's impressive that Marc Jacobs was able to get as big as he did, staying cool.
Yeah.
I think that's more the exception than the rule.
Yeah, definitely. And then also I think for me, my ideas, I'll give you an example. So the first thing I did for Supreme was like André 3000. You know, we shot André. That's part of the thing too of being creative director. It's like your influence with people, not influence, but like I have a relationship with André that's just based off friendship and we have worked together. So I don't know if the answer would have been yes if I wasn't involved.
Of course, you have relationships.
Yeah. So then André's down to do it, and then there's an array of images that we've shot, and the images that I felt were the best were him with the flute. Because the reason I felt they're the best, because they were where he's at right now. And the images we went with were, you know, not that much different. It was same clothing, not different poses, but no flute. And the discourse from James was, well, would you rather hear him rap or play the flute if you're going to a show? And my response to them was, I'd rather hear him play the flute because that's where he's at right now.
Do, yeah. Has James ever heard him play the flute? So
no.
So then how do you know?
Exactly. What you'd rather hear? Yeah. So it's interesting because for a brand that's so like, we're cool and we're genuine, we're real. For me, it was a bit of a cosplay thing because it's like, we want to present something that feels like André is a rapper. But me, I'm like, let's present him in his realest form, which is he walks around with that flute all day, every day. It's an appendage. So end of the day, James the boss, we did the image without the flute.
Definitely.
People loved it. Cool.
Yeah.
But I'm just using that as an example of that's how everything kind of went, which in situations where the stuff was more charged or more, there's more discourse about images or stories we should be telling, ideas, it's the same kind of thing where it's like, I'm presenting it. If you want to do it, do it. Don't do it. And then, but then it still kind of all falls on me, but I actually don't have any control.
Yeah.
And then that just puts me in a compromising place with the artists that we're working with. And just most importantly, compromising place within myself, where I'm just like, well, why am I even here? And so it just got really political there with project with Arthur Jaffa, which was kind of the boiling point for me resigning from there. I had pitched in February or March 2022 to do a project with Arthur Jaffa. Everyone was excited about it. AJ's an amazing artist, but it's not even about him being this big blue chip artist. Any artist that's allowing us to work with them, in my opinion, it should be their discretion which works they want to do. So AJ made his discretion of the imagery he wanted to use. James was into it and said, yeah, this stuff's really important. The imagery was visceral, some of it. One image was of a freed slave. His back had the wounds from when he was a slave being whipped. And another image was a diptych, which was two images together, which is basically you could call it the Guernica for African Americans.
Definitely.
And you know, the Guernica is the Picasso painting, which is of a war, image of killing, of war. This image is an image of two black men who have been hung for, they're accused of rape, I think down in Memphis, but they were never tried and they were hung. And there's a bunch of people, white people that hung them, standing around them, looking at the camera, taking a picture. And then the next picture is Grape Street Crips with guns. So the name of that piece is called I Don't Care About Your Past, I Just Want Our Love to Last. AJ's intention in that picture is to show this got you this.
Yeah.
It's connected.
Yeah.
You know, there's that documentary, The Bastards of the Party, saying that the Bloods and Crips are the bastard sons of the African-American political parties that fell apart post-civil rights movement, during the crack epidemic. So there's that piece. There's another image, La Rage. And so anyway, those images got approved. The clothing got made. I get sick. You know, that stuff's supposed to come out, was supposed to come out spring 23. I got sick in fall 22. I'm in hospital for 3 months. When I get out the hospital, I'm on medical leave in total 8 months. When I come back, the project is in stasis. And I'm like, oh, what's going on, you know? And before I can even ask, an email sent by an employee, we had two employees raise concerns about the imagery, which they have the right to.
Okay.
So they raised concerns about the imagery. The first employee, we had a discussion, me, her, and the other C-suite team. And I explained to her AJ's intention and Supreme's intention. I'm a conduit for both of those intentions as the creative director in the artwork. And she's like, oh, is this stuff going to be explained to the artwork? I said, yeah. And then she said, I'm cool with it. And then the next employee, so April 1st, which was coincidentally the day I returned back to work from medical leave, 8 months of medical leave from having the lower aortic aneurysm, the employee sent an email to the C-suite saying he felt wise, Supreme thinks it's okay to profit off this terrible imagery. And he's a black dude. So then he sent me an email saying, hey, Tremaine, I'd like to talk. So I thought he was going to talk to me about the AJ piece. And we talk. And he says, hey, so you want to talk about the AJ piece? So I'm ready to give him, again, repeat AJ's attention with the work and Supreme's attention. And then he says, oh, no, I talked to James about it already. I want to talk to you about, it's tough for me working here as a black person where you seem to be flourishing here. How do you flourish here when there's, it bothers me that the clothing and the stuff we make is largely based off black culture, but there's not a lot of black people in the design team, right? And I told them, I haven't worked anywhere where there was a large amount of black people around working in these type of institutions. Only place I ever worked where there was a lot of black people was at Grady's Liquor Store. So it's something that I'm used to. And it's something that within reason and within my power, not just for black people, for all people, I try to diversify workplaces that I'm in based off people with talent that can do the job. And I also try to make it diverse as far as women, but it's all the same to me. Having women involved, having working class people involved of any color, having people of any gender, it's all the same to me.
Yeah, just people who are good. People who are good at their job and are going to make the team a better team.
Yeah. Yeah, I want to make it diverse with talented people. And I said, I'm doing what I can. I've had discussions with HR since I've came here. They told me they're trying to make things I haven't seen that happen yet. Let me know what I can do to help you. He's like, well, just this conversation's helped me. And we had a great conversation. And then, you know, a couple weeks before I resigned, he resigned. He resigned for feeling disgruntled about feeling his upward trajectory, Supreme, and feeling there are some racial insensitivities there. Those are his opinions. I had conversations with HR about that. They said they were addressing the stuff, but he decided to resign, and also he had his other reasons. So from April 1st to August, it's 4 months, no one talked to me about the AJ project. So I was building my strength back up.
It was a surprise what happened to you. Tell me what happened physically.
I had a lower aortic aneurysm, which was—
Did you know it was something?
No, but it was hereditary, but I didn't know it ran in my family.
I see.
I found out after the fact that I had an uncle that died from one in his 20s. So my main focus was my recovery. So I was—
How did it reveal itself? Like, what was the event?
The event was, started to feel a sharp pain in my chest first. Then I felt a sharp pain. Actually, the chain pain I felt in my chest was actually my aorta. So I was feeling it from my chest, felt short of breath, thought I was having a heart attack, and then I felt this excruciating pain in my back.
Upper back?
Yeah.
Between the shoulders?
Between the shoulders, which was my aorta dissecting. It was splitting. And then that pain kind of subsided, and then I had my leg went numb because the lower part of my aorta, the dissection ended there, and it ripped apart. And that's usually when people die from it, within like 3 or 4 minutes. That's why it's called— the nickname for it, it's called the Widowmaker. John Ritter from Three's Company, he died from it. But some reason, it ripped, but a little piece of it held on. So I was bleeding internally, but not full out bleeding. So my leg went numb. And that's when my wife, my girlfriend at the time, called the ambulance, went to get the ambulance, and, you know, saved my life. If I wouldn't have been with her, I definitely would have died. And then we got to the hospital. It took them a long time to diagnose it, the first hospital. And then about 8 hours later, an amazing doctor, she came on, and she immediately started asking me certain questions and got me to get a scan. And then she realized I had was suffering an aneurysm. And she called up to Cornell, which is some of the best doctors for that type of cardiac things. I went and had an emergency surgery that was supposed to be 3 hours, ended up being 8 hours, spent a month in the ICU.
Wow.
Yeah, I mean, I almost died 3 times from the initial thing, and then had got pneumonia. Then I got a sepsis, blood infection. And then also I was on dialysis for about 3 months. So I did a month in the ICU, and then they moved me up to Baker unit. I did rehab for 2 months, and then came home December 28th and recovered at home doing PT 3 times a week with my amazing physical trainer, Jacqueline Paler, doing my doctor checkups. And I've had an amazing— but yeah, miracle recovered me. I mean, my doctor said it was a 5% chance of me living.
Wow.
But I got very lucky, and then, you know, have a very important person to live for, which is Andy. So she was there with me, sleeping on a lazy boy every night for 3 months, which I think that helped me, really gave me the strength to, you know, when you're recovering, there's medicine, and then there's willpower, wanting to be here, pushing with that. I don't know if it's your molecules, your soul, what the energy is, but it takes the mix of all those things, you know. And I had a lot of love, mainly Andy and my dad, and Anthony and A-Side and Chris, other people too. Just, you know, I got this friend Cactus, she'd be flying in to visit me from Hawaii, you know, coming to visit me in the hospital, my brother, other friends coming to visit me, and all that love mixed with the amazing work from the doctors helped me get me back. But definitely the main protagonist is Andy. Definitely, she'd get out of work and she'd come straight to the hospital, hang out with me, and then stay the night, go to work, come back every day for 3 months. I don't know how I would have done it without that support.
I mean, I'm so happy you're here.
Me too.
Yeah.
Me too.
So happy you're here. How has that experience changed you?
The only way it's changed me is when I met Andy, from the day I met her, I knew she was special. And then she became an amazing colleague and then became an amazing friend. And then we fell in love right before I got sick, like a month or two before I got sick, a month before I got sick. And once I got better, I just didn't waste any time. Where before, I'm like, I should have just asked her to marry me. I knew. And when I first month dating, I should have just asked her. But you know, you tell yourself, oh, well, let me wait and see. And I'm not saying that's wrong either, but that's what I was thinking when I was waiting for the ambulance in the hallway in my apartment. I was like, if I got to survive, I'm gonna marry Andy. That was my thought. That was my last thought, was my little brother McCoy. My dad had a kid. He had my brother 3 years ago with his amazing wife Shelley. And what I thought before I went into surgery was, well, I need more time with Andy and McCoy. So when I got survived, that's what changed. It's just me trying to spend as much time within reason with Andy and people I love. But I did that before that, because that's what, again, this whole talk. My dad and my mom are always like, hey, we're not paralyzed tomorrow. We gotta have fun. People might consider it morbid. My dad talked about death a lot because both my mom and my dad, my mom talked about death a lot because she lost two of her brothers when she was a kid.
Definitely.
One to the aneurysm and one came back sick from Vietnam. So at a young age, she had a lot of loss of two people she loved very much. She would speak about that. She always say, Tremaine, I'm not gonna be here forever. Take care of you, you gotta figure it out, you know? And she's like, you gotta look out for your little brother when I'm not here. And then my dad, his sense of mortality came from, he was a TV news cameraman. So he's like basically a coroner. He saw death every day. So yeah, he gets to do cool things like cover a Yankees game or the Super Bowl or go to the White House. But mainly, they're selling death. They're selling the fact that, you know, a lot of, and so he'd cover all kinds of stuff. And that just made him say, hey, man, this guy died from a crane falling on him. This person got murdered. And he'd tell the stories, but the end of the story was always like, that's why we gotta be nice to each other and have as much fun as possible, because we are not guaranteed a second. So it didn't make me more like, oh, I appreciate my life more and I'm gonna go for it more. Actually, it made me like, you know what? This work stuff's cool, but that's why, like, me and Andy, we went on a month honeymoon. I'm like, he's like, I survived. You were there with me. We got married. We're going away for a month.
Great.
You know what I mean?
Great.
We're going away for a month. That's what I learned from, is just spend as much time with Andy and McCoy and the other people that I love. But I already knew that. And also just maybe just this work shit is not as important. It's just not. It's art's important, and it's important for me to be fulfilled, because I won't be the best husband or father. We don't have a kid yet, but I won't be able to be the best husband or father if I'm not fulfilled. Same for Andy, same for McCoy, same for everyone, you know? So that is important, but not at the expense of, in my opinion, what I've time with people you love, you know?
Yeah.
You know what? We talked about fear a lot. It put not the fear of death in me. It put the fear of not spending what I feel is an adequate amount of time with people I respect, I care about, and love.
Understood.
That's so, because before I never feared death. I'm like, why would I? I'm like, it's going to happen. And the way my parents raised me. But I still don't fear death, but I fear not having enough time with Andy.
Yeah.
Because she's like one of the most amazing people I ever met. So I have that fear, and the way I meet that fear is by letting her know how much I value her, what she's done for me, and even letting her know what she means to me, and then spending time and having fun.
Just great.
Yeah. So that's what I learned. Same thing with McCoy. Same thing with A-Side. Same thing with Frazier and David, Chris, the friends, you know? Even, like, with you, you know, it's like, we're cool, man. Like, I could see someone that I'm really cool with, a friend, and it's like, you know what? I was like, I'm going to hit Rick when I'm in L.A.
Yeah.
And if we can meet up, we can meet up. Yeah. So, might not see you for a year again. Maybe we'll never see each other again. But we made time to see each other on this one, like we've done in the past. So, that's what I try to do. You can't see everyone all the time. But within reason, I rotate it. And then I have my, you know, my main concern is Andy. That's my number one thing.
Do you think of yourself as a spiritual person?
I don't. But then even what I'm about to say, might some could say could be considered spiritual. I think life is meaningless. And we put the meaning, you put the meaning into it. And then you're like loved ones that you think you want to give to meaning to life. So maybe that is spiritual. I'm not well-read in all the religions, but I know stuff from some, from, you know, the Bible, from Buddhism, Joseph Campbell, you know, Miyamoto Musashi, Five Rings, the Book of Five Rings, Tao Jeet Kune Do, can go on and on, comic books. That's what I'm saying, you know, those are biblical to me, comic books. That's stuff I've learned. You learn from comic books, you know, like the X-Men. Professor X was based off Martin Luther King, and Magneto was based off Malcolm X. And it was a Trojan horse to tell that story through these mutants. The mutants represented African Americans in America, you know what I mean? So I've learned more from that than I learned from the Bible. Hmm. But just only because I've read more comic books than I've read the Bible. So, you know, I'm agnostic, and when people hear that, I think they think atheist, and it's not. I don't subscribe to any religion, or that there's an omnipotent being with human,
or that there's not,
yeah, mm-hmm. Or that omnipotent being has human traits, because mm-hmm. That's the thing about humans. We're like humans as a whole. We're narcissists, and we're like, you know, it's like someone sees an alien, it kind of looks human.
Yeah, and when we look at clouds, we see faces.
We see faces because it's like, you know. Whereas, does a dog see a face in a cloud? No, maybe probably not. I'll tell you this, I felt spiritual the first time I saw the sun after being in the ICU for a month.
Yeah.
I realized that the sun that I hadn't seen in a month from being in my hospital room and the sun that I thought I never was going to see again was the same that sun that shined on every living being, that everything that's lived in the Milky Way, this universe, our galaxy, the Earth, the dinosaurs, my mom, who's no longer here.
The same sun.
It shined on every living organism that has ever spurned from the earth to the last one. The sun, that same sun that I hadn't saw, that I took for granted.
Yeah.
I felt that connection when I felt the sun in my wheelchair with my shades on. And I took my shades off and I started crying. Chris was there and my other friend Chris was there. I remember, you know, texting Andy the picture and my dad. So I guess I am spiritual. Maybe not by the textbook definition.
Definitely.
You know, for me, my religion, like, I find religion in people. You know, like people that I connect with, I find religion in, like, in the relationship. So yeah. I found religion in relationship with A-Side. I found religion in my relationship with my friend Frazier. And I think I found my highest religion in my relationship with Andy.
So I guess religion ultimately is about connection.
Yeah.
That's what it is.
Yeah, connection. You know what, though? The one thing I'll say, which hasn't been said about the whole thing with me and Supreme, when I really think about it, and my friend Jimmy illuminated to me, was the issue between me and Supreme was, I don't really get uncomfortable about talking about anything. And the top brass there was uncomfortable to talk to me about that imagery and them wanting to change it out or not use it. And when people get uncomfortable and have fear gets in them, that's when mistakes and miscommunications and feelings and, shit goes awry. And, you know, they didn't, I guess they just didn't have it in them to even have the conversation, which is all, again, go back to the Converse thing, the discourse. Because even, you asked me if I ever have been censored, yes. There was another shoe I was gonna do at Converse with my friend, artist Dan Colin. And he has a farm called Skyhawk Farm. And we're exploring stuff with food and design and black food. So we're gonna do a Converse of a watermelon rind, the skin of a watermelon. So Converse felt that was controversial and they felt it could be interpreted as racist, right? Because of minstrel imagery in the past of blacks and watermelons. But the thing is, I never...
Were these white people who were concerned about it being racist?
Both.
Okay.
Black and white people.
Okay.
But the difference in the situation was, they called me, they told me they weren't down, they didn't want to do it. They were uncomfortable with the imagery.
Yeah.
And they didn't want to do it, but they weren't uncomfortable with having the conversation.
Right. They were straight.
Straight up. And we had the conversation. They said, we're not going to put these out. And I was like, you guys are kind of wasting my time.
Yeah.
And I think you guys are aiding and abetting, which you think you're protecting.
Yep.
But cool. And that's why I never posted anything like,
yeah,
Converse has done something wrong.
Do you ever get the feeling when something like that happens, do you ever feel like I'm going to find another way to get these shoes out?
My whole thing was, it was like that silhouette of the Chuck. And then working with Dan and Sky High Farm and telling that. I have art and things I've made with that imagery of the watermelon. It's going to come out in different places.
Okay.
Yeah, so it will come out. But again, did they censor me? I guess, but they talked to me.
Yeah.
And we were able to have discourse. We disagreed, but it was fine in the end because I respected that they have a right to make a choice as a company to not want to put it out. And they respected me by hearing me out why I feel we should. And we talked about it and moved on, you know. And I guess because we had that situation with the Pan-African shoes and it went well. And we, you know, I was happy with the outcome of that and donating the money to Black Voters Matters. And so that's the thing where it's like, I'm about, not about getting my way, I'm about discourse. And then wherever the chips fall, I'm okay with that, as long as the talk happens, you know?
Yeah. Tell me from where you sit, describe the fashion industry and paint a picture of what the fashion industry is and how does it work?
The fashion industry currently is no different than the film industry in a sense of Paramount or Caring Group, they're a bank, and they invest in directors, creative directors. So whether, you know, Matthew Blase or I think Apple did Killers of the Flower Moon, Apple invested in Martin Scorsese and they want you to give the world clothing, tell a story so it could sell and they can make more money than it did last year. That's the fashion industry. That's where it is now. That's not how it started.
Where do you think it started? And where do you think, when do you think it changed?
Fashion really started with the creation of the bourgeoisie, right? When people had a superfluous amount of money.
Before that, people just wore work clothes or base standard uniform. Everybody dressed the same.
Yeah. Actually, I would say fashion started in tribal times. Really, when I really think about stuff I've read, tribal times to signify different things and to signify hierarchies or this, that, and the third within tribes. You know, you'd see it across different indigenous things. But then once agriculture happened and humans were able to make a superfluous amount of food, they were able to do other things, become musicians, make clothing.
Because before that, everybody had to
hunter-gather. All your time was spent was finding food.
Right.
So you didn't have time to make a flannel shirt. You had time to be like, okay, I got something to wear for my feet so I could chase down this animal. You know, everything was purposeful.
Yeah.
So then once agricultural revolution happened, and agricultural revolution happened because people wanted to be stationary to go to church. So to be stationary and not to be moving all the time as hunter-gatherers, you had to make a superfluous amount of food. So once that happened, made a superfluous amount of food, people were able to become scientists, soldiers. And once the barter system stopped and money, then it was like, that's when the bourgeoisie of any type of civilization was created, whether it's the Egyptians, the French, whatever. And they started having clothes to represent who they were.
It was like the haves and the have-nots.
Yeah.
And the haves wore fashionable clothing to separate themselves from the masses.
Yes. But then the have-nots, the proletariat, they wore clothing to get a job done. Denim. Denim was created because the other cotton fabrics that were worn would get torn, and then they would have to bring in loads of pants to change into as their pants got torn. So that was more work, bringing in these extra pants. Once denim was created, you didn't have to bring all these denim with you because your denim would last you for a couple months or something. That was function. But then eventually denim became fashion.
I feel like that might have been as recently as the 70s when denim became fashion.
Yeah, because even like, you
know, Gloria Vanderbilt.
Yeah, clothing was originally, not originally, but there was like couture. So you had, let's say, Christian Dior. He was designing couture dresses and stuff, right? And only a certain amount of people could afford it. But not just the money, it goes back to the artisan thing. There's only a certain amount that can made. Then the advent of ready-to-wear happened, where it was clothing that was still made well, but not couture, so it could be made in higher quantities, and it could cost less. So more people, it was still a bourgeoisie thing, but more people could buy it. Then ready-to-wear went to the level where then the Industrial Revolution, they're able to make clothing cheaply at higher numbers. So then the fashions that, let's say, a mom or a dad saw someone wearing, you could go buy it in Walmart, a version of it. And then it all trickled down to where we're at now, where like you see something on TikTok and you can click on it and it takes you to a link and you can buy something, you know? But it's a long history, but like you said, kind of recent.
Yeah.
It's short.
Yeah.
You know, it's short because businessmen are like, hey, people want to be like Elvis. What if we make shoes that look like Elvis's shoes? You know, I remember the last page of the book, Please Kill Me. The book goes through the whole oral history of the punk scene. And the book ends in Hawaii to this guy who had died in childhood. And his first show he went to was, he saw Elvis. And he said all he remembered from the show was his shoes. That's where fashion really started, when the proliferation of celebrity culture and then people wanting to buy Beatle boots.
Yeah.
Buy shirts like James Brown. Like my dad, my grandfather got so mad at my dad because my dad's first check, $99, that he got from my grandfather for making bricks, he went and bought to Augusta, Georgia, bought some pants and a silk shirt and some Stack Hills to look like James Brown and spend all his money. That's really
where... He got it at the place where James Brown got him, probably.
Probably,
in Augusta.
Yeah, in Augusta.
Yeah.
And that's where I think when celebrity culture hit with the music, that's where I think fashion really took off, was with musicians. Because, you know, actors, cool, you see the actor wearing it, but back then you didn't really see actors.
Only in the movies.
Only in the movies.
Right.
But musicians, you see the musicians and they're on stage and you see David Bowie or Mick Jagger or whoever and you're like, oh shit, I want to wear that. And then brands start making stuff, not just based off that. A lot of it was ushered in by Karl Lagerfeld and Yves Saint Laurent. You know, there's this book called The Beautiful Fall. I haven't read all of it, but I started reading it. And it's about how the explosion of, like you said, the 70s, of fashion in Paris in the 70s, and the competition between Yves Saint Laurent and Karl Lagerfeld. And, you know, Yves took over Dior, worked there for like 3 seasons or 3 years. He got fired, then eventually started his own label. Karl was working at a bunch of different places and then eventually got to Chanel. And then it just exploded from that, you know? Just like shit exploded from fucking Chuck Berry and Elvis and a couple people, and then rock and roll exploded. Same thing with fashion, you know? To the point now where you have companies that, you know, Denim Tears. There's so many bootlegs out there, you know? So they're selling.
Can you always tell what's a bootleg?
Yeah.
Can most people tell?
If they want to.
Tell me about it. Tell me about the bootleg market.
The bootleg market has existed for a long time. And it's basically, if you're popping, you're getting bootlegged. It's funny, I remember a talk between Virgil had all these activations happening in London. Him and Kim were doing a talk and asked the question, I know you guys both, but Kim, how did you know that Virgil had made it? He says, when I went to China, saw all the bootlegs, you know? So bootleg is really kind of like, lets you know you have pierced culture if your stuff's being bootlegged. Mm-hmm. If you're not being bootlegged, you're not.
It's not hot.
Some people don't know, but people do know, and it's just like, there's like they bootleg and they're selling for like $40. 99% of the time, the bootleg is way lower quality than the original.
Yeah, and there's no R&D that goes into it. It's just a straight up copy.
Exactly. So I got to pay Daniel. I got to pay my whole team, my time.
Got to have the ideas.
Got to have the ideas. You got to make it. You got to make samples. Where the bootlegger just buys your piece.
Copies it
and makes it. So that's part of why they could sell it a lot cheaper. And then usually the quality is horrible. That's another reason why they could sell it cheaper. But it's interesting, like this era of bootlegging, it's new because now people are bootlegging your stuff and creating their own versions, designs. And then the bootlegger feels, well, they take your IP and they're like, it's my IP now.
Yeah.
So there's the thought of like, there's no, everything's open, kind of like open source. So there's no IP anymore.
Yeah, it's interesting.
And I'm like, interesting, you know?
No, it's just interesting to think about.
Yeah.
I had a conversation with James Peirce and he started as a Grateful Dead bootlegger.
Wow, sick.
Yeah.
Wow, that's amazing.
And now he's done collaboration with them, you know, all that's these incredible. Years later.
That's incredible.
Yeah.
No, yeah, that's the funny thing about the bootleg. It's like, it's not like bootlegging liquor back in Prohibition days, where it's like, they're bootlegging that because it's illegal. And also the bootleggers are like, they're filling in the gaps of, okay, I can make a certain amount of jeans. I have a certain amount of money that I pay to get it made. And then once they sell out, they sell out. It might take me 3 months. Actually, it does. Like, for me to invest and remake the stuff, if I re-release it, it takes months. You know, like my sweatsuits, they're puff print and they're paneled. It's not like I could take a blank and put the print on it. It's paneled so that it's seamless and the print looks good and it's not shitty. That takes 3 months, so 2-3 months for me to do it. So people want this stuff. The bootlegger is doing a much not as good version, but they're getting it out to the people. So maybe the person just doesn't want to wait. Plus it's cheaper. They don't care. So that's kind of the bootleg game. But it's interesting now, like people bootlegging and doing it and putting their spin on it. It's interesting. It's funny. And it's almost like the bootleggers will be mad at you. Like, you're copying us. It's like, I created this, but cool, man. Yeah. You know, my thing with the bootleggers is like, have fun, but I'm going to keep putting my stuff out.
Of course.
So it's almost like, in the end, the choice is up to the customer.
How do you handle fulfillment of sales?
Okay, there's these flannels that I have made in Japan. They get made, we ship them over on a boat, hopefully, because it's cheaper to ship them on a boat and more environmentally sound to ship them on a boat than fly them. They get to the port, clear through customs. They don't come to my studio. They go straight to the
fulfillment center,
and then they get packaged there. And then when someone buys it off denimtears.com, it gets fulfilled from there. And my one wholesale account, Dover Street Market, it gets fulfilled from there too. So that's how that works, yeah.
Tell me something you believe now that you didn't believe when you were younger.
I didn't believe that I'd be like living like so much of my adult life without my mom. I was ignorant and I didn't listen to her and my dad about mortality, I thought I was gonna have her as long as I had my nana and my grandma, who I just said her birthday was 97.
Yeah.
My mom died at 58. Yeah. So when I was younger, I just, you know, I was a mom's, still am a mom's boy, and I just thought I was gonna have my mom a lot longer than I did. But we had great times, so, you know, grateful for all the time we did have, but I thought I was gonna have her longer than I did. To lose her at 33 was pretty, like, I was like, man. But then, you know what? I think your compassion comes from when you realize there's someone that never knew their mom. And then that's how you circumvent grief. Not that I don't miss my mom, but then I just...
Could have been worse,
you know? And like the union of my mom and dad and our little family, I assume my mom died, it got shattered. Not shattered like we don't talk to each other, but we kind of all went off on our own paths. My little brother, my dad, you know, my dad got remarried. I went, you know, just kind of like tunnel vision with work. So did my little brother. So I just thought I'd be go visiting my parents down south where they retired to.
Yeah.
So, which is kind of the same thing. So that's the thing that's different in my adult life that I thought it would be that way when I was a kid.